best charity event.
You want to know the truth? I don't even know. She was telling me something this morning. I was rushing out the door. I don't even follow all of her charity work. I mean, I don't know the answers.
There is a link, apparently, on the website.
Yeah, it's going to be a great event in Pittsburgh. I mean, she's going. She got a friend who's a comedian, Eddie, and then she got a friend who was doing something else, and it's World Magazine. You know, it's a glamorous event, I guess. I don't know. But they got a good cause. They're trying to raise money for the animals who are being killed in the shelters and things, I guess. Or something. And I'm a supporter of that. I love animals. I got four animals living in my house.
Now, do you think someone's going to take best bra off at this event?
No, I don't. I don't.
Oh, my goodness.
I think Beth will show up. She's great to look at, in my opinion.
You know, there's nothing sexier than that whenever Beth goes and gets molested by, like, someone who's supposed to massage her.
Yeah, I love it, too.
Oh, it's amazing, Howard. The only thing I fear is that male Korean guy who came in the middle, he might have had an Apple iPhone.
Right. Well, according to Beth, I talked to her last night about it. She said the guy was like this little guy. He had no idea what was going on. She has every confidence that nothing.
It wasn't like some kind of a setup.
What if Beth is going to be like a big time star in North Korea in the porn industry?
Yesterday. For tickets to Beth's charity event, go to showclicks.com. I guess you could find that information there. How's that?
Very good.
And they are auctioning off two pictures that I took, the two of the same pictures. I put them on, thanks to my friends at Bay Photo, I put them on a big metal frame. They're huge. And you hang that in your house, and you'll see. It's beautiful. It'll brighten your day.
Okay, Howard, great. I'm going to try to show up, put a ticket on my credit card. But this one thing about the Channel 9 show, this is slightly off topic. I don't want to annoy you, but why was everybody's teeth so bad during that time period? Yours, Fred's?
Teeth?
Your teeth.
Well, listen, I have legendary bad teeth. My mother, God love her. You know, I don't believe in all of this carrying gun. What is with the teeth? You know, I got a set of teeth that the dentist said to her, I'm begging you, Mrs. Stern, the boy needs teeth to be straightened. I've got a bite that is so fucked up that my lower teeth bang into my upper teeth and have literally killed my two front teeth. It's unbelievable. And if I had had some braces, which this guy, my mother goes, those braces are dangerous. I know a young lady got braces. Her teeth are loose. This is what I heard my whole life. And the dentist is bad, and Novocaine is bad. And
sounds like Richard Christie's dad with his theories on things. I met one person.
Yeah, it's like my mother's Amish and afraid of anything in the modern society. I mean, you should hear her now because she's old. They're always at the doctor, and they're pretty healthy people, but there's always some issue. These doctors, they get a hold of you. We waited there, your father and I. And she gets so emotional. And with the teeth, when I was growing up, so, you know, my sister didn't get braces. I didn't get braces. My niece, when she wanted braces, my mother got a hold of my sister. Don't you put braces on her. My niece went out. I don't know how she did it. And got her own braces. She had beautiful teeth now. She's an adult
now. She got her own braces.
Yeah, she went out and somehow, because I'm in a family of lunatics.
That's an industrious and creative little girl.
My niece is a wonderful girl. Both my nieces.
Howard, I don't even know if braces would have helped your teeth the way they look. They look like every teeth, they were all like vampire teeth. Everyone.
They were bad teeth. My parents, I mean, what, my mother would be, what is with this vanity? Everybody with the looks, I look inward. I don't care about outer beauty. I mean, meanwhile, my mother, whenever she goes somewhere, she gets dressed up. She always immaculate, always into the clothing. For herself, she's worried, you know.
You're on your own.
You with the beauty. I mean, you're beautiful. Don't worry about it. I mean, it was the wrong, it was completely misguided. But anyway, as a result, after I saw the movie Private Parts, my dentist, Matthew Kaufman, Robin knows him, I went to him and I said, look, what do you think with these teeth? And he said to me, look, you know, we can do some things for you. cosmetically. So they took my lower teeth and a couple of them, they put like a cap on there.
Mm-hmm.
You can barely see my teeth because my mouth is very small. And the reason my mouth is small, everything's crowded in there. I tell you what's going on there, it's despicable. The dentist said to my mother, and it wasn't like we grew up in Siberia. We had a dentist
there
in Belmore.
A dentist right around the
yeah,
corner.
Yeah, he knew, he was a good guy. I mean, he knew his thing. And without a whole different situation. You know, I got to sleep with a piece of plastic in my mouth to keep my lower teeth from banging into my upper teeth.
Wow.
I mean, every night I have to put this plastic device in.
Would you consider braces now?
No, no, no.
Why not?
Too late.
It can be done.
It's too late.
It's never too late.
So listen to this. On Wednesday, I got to sit for because my upper teeth look horrible. Because, yes, I had them done years ago, but now they, as you get older, they change, you know, they shift around in your mouth or something.
Is that right?
That's it, yeah. So now I'm going in, they're going to give me new uppers.
What do you mean?
They're going to cosmetically do some bonding and this and that, because you can see the it's
what's going on?
What's going on? It doesn't look right. And believe me, I said to my dentist, I said, you know what, I don't give a fuck. I'm married, my wife's happy. I said, who's looking at my teeth? I'm not doing it. I said, to sit in the fucking chair.
But he's not going to give you...
2 hours Wednesday, two Wednesdays in a row.
Yeah, those things that look like they belong in someone else's mouth.
What, like Gary's teeth, the big chick? No, my teeth now, the same thing I have. They just got to go in and fix them.
All right, because I was looking at Martin Scorsese.
Yeah, no, I'm not getting that.
Last night, and when he, you know, you Checklets. Very rarely see his teeth, but every once in a while he smiles.
It's ridiculous.
It's like, whose teeth is he using?
Yeah, no. These teeth that I have here, these front ones, it's the same idea.
Okay.
And you can see, I don't look like I have fake.
No, they look good.
I'm very aware of that, but now I got to sit in that chair. So before the summer started, the dentist said to me, you got to go do this. It's time. He goes, you know me, I'm very conservative, but I see it's time to do it.
Does it take a lot of drilling?
It's a lot of sitting, and now I'm involved, and God only knows, and then there's adjustments and all kinds of shit.
Yeah.
So I basically said to him, listen, between you and me, I don't give a fuck anymore. I'm happy with the teeth.
But you
I got.
Need your teeth to be okay.
Yeah, well, this is all cosmetic. It has nothing
really?
To do. Yeah. Yeah. Listen to me. It's cosmetic.
That's what you need.
So,
Pete.
Yeah, exactly. So, I said I don't need it. It ain't that bad. Well, he got a hold of my wife. And he explained to her what he wanted to do. So, she came home and she said to me, listen, all right, the dentist showed me what he's going to do. I think he should do it. So I said, all right, if you're telling me I should do it, I trust her. I'm going to go do it. So I made my appointment. I'm going to go get it done. And then yesterday I was so fucking... I don't want to spend 2 hours in the dentist chair 2 weeks in a row.
I hate the dentist. And I can't go back to back a lot of times because it drives me crazy.
Well, now I'm thinking I'll bring my iPad. Maybe I'll watch some movies. I don't know. Something to pass the time so I don't feel like it's crazy. So yesterday I saw Ralph and I said, Ralph, yeah, you're a pretty honest guy. I said, do me a favor. I got to go for the... I said, I'm thinking of backing...
They haven't started yet?
No, it starts Wednesday. I said, I'm thinking of backing out of this whole thing.
Uh-huh.
He looked me over. He said, no, you got to go do it.
Mm.
Oh, I'll go do it. Everyone wants me to be beautiful. I don't care. I mean, listen. Teeth ain't going to change what I got going on this face. It's a mess.
What was going on in that time period, though, for all of you on the Channel 9 days? It just seemed like everybody was a mess. You know, the hygiene wasn't great.
The hygiene wasn't great. What are you? Who are you
Robin,
trying?
Robin. Oh my!
Cleanest
God.
Girl on the planet.
Robin had a shaved head.
Oh well, that doesn't mean she wasn't clean. You're talking. You're bringing up.
Can't get cleaner than that.
Yeah, she shaved her head. That was the year she had head lice. She had a shave.
There seemed to be a lot of issues with her. Her eyes were wacky at the time period.
Robin?
Yeah, absolutely.
You're crazy.
I remember, I think it was the Sternly Wet Game in the Channel 9 video. And Robin was real uncomfortable dealing with your wife, Allison, at the time. She was looking at Fred.
What? She was good friends with her. What are you talking about?
She was good friends, but there was also a little envious nature that she was...
Well, of course. Robin's in love with me. Of course she's envious.
You're funny.
Now, yeah. But at one point...
That was when Robin and I were in the middle of a huge affair that nobody knew about. Of course it was uncomfortable.
at that time, you know. And now, now she's off, and she needs to find love, hopefully. And I'll talk to you later.
All right, Pete. Thank you.
Whoa, he's all over the place today.
Your hygiene was bad. You know, Robin, I meant to talk to you about that. Those years were horrible.
You can see it through the TV.
That BO of yours was awful. Al Roker's here, Gary. You have on a sheet 6:45. I tell you, with this Gary, oh, it says out by 6:45. 6:50. All right. Well, I would love to talk to Al Roker. Have him come on in. I love the guy.
Yeah, I guess we're between things on the Today Show or something.
6:15, out by 6:45. This guy's got some schedule. This guy's got more television shows.
He's a busy, busy man. Hello.
You look good.
Yeah, he does.
You kept the weight off. I never thought in my life I'd see you do it.
I think he's gotten thinner.
My money was against you. I lost, I think, $10,000 on a bet.
I think you've gotten thinner, haven't you?
I don't know. I'm buying bigger
shoes. What do you weigh now?
About 205.
205. I would have said less.
Yeah.
I mean, it's tremendous accomplishment in your life. You were always known as the fat guy on the Today Show.
The fat funny guy, yeah.
Yeah, the fat funny guy.
Now, are you still funny? Because they say when the fat goes, the funny goes.
You know, it's like, you know, there are people going on with Jonah Hill and Drew Carey. I mean, it's like, what? It's not. You know, it's not fun. Actually, fat's not all that funny. It's sweaty and, you know.
You know what it is? Jonah Hill is successful because he's odd-looking and he's fat and people could relate to him.
Right.
It's relatability.
Sure.
So now, I mean, you know, Jonah Hill has lost weight. I had him on the show recently and he's, you know, he goes, I'm very insulted that people think I won't be funny because I'm thin.
Yeah, what is that?
But it could change.
It could.
I mean,
he's
not a leading man.
No.
They cast him as a funny-looking fat guy.
Well, so now he's a funny-looking thin guy.
You know, that's true.
He's still funny-looking. He hasn't lost that.
Really? I mean, oh, by the way, going to the dentist, get the nitrous oxide.
No, I don't do that.
Oh,
no, I'm not getting drilled. I'm just getting some cosmetic work.
Then. Yeah. Oh, please.
You got, what did you do to your teeth? You got nice teeth.
When I was a kid, I was so uncoordinated. I was playing punch ball, you know, and I went to go catch and I stepped on the ball, feet went out from under, slammed down face first. Most people use their hands to break the fall.
Right.
I use my face and broke these teeth and it was a mess. So, yeah, I mean, I've had caps and the whole nine.
The whole thing.
Yeah.
My mother never got me braces.
I know. I had braces. I mean, braces. The greatest thing about braces, especially when you're in high school, is that, you know, especially if, you know, you go back up in there, you know, after lunch, you can find a snack or two.
Well, it's just kind of like, you know, it's like I grew up Amish, but I grew up on Long Island.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird. A lot of fears in my family about things. You know what I mean?
Oh, my mother, I mean, she had me slapped, had braces, anything, glass. I mean, I was wearing glasses when I was in first grade. I had braces, you know, I was in fifth grade.
You got it all.
I'm sure you've told me this before, but it must have been a while before you got laid the first time.
Like about 5 years ago.
You are a ladies' man. I mean, you have a beautiful wife. But it was hard in the beginning. You told me that it wasn't until college.
Yeah, it was college, like sophomore year of college.
Yeah, I mean, it took you a long time.
Sophomore, not even a freshman.
A long time.
Were you going out of your mind? Because, you know, I remember when I was 16, it became the driving force in my life was to get laid. Like, I had to find out what this mystery was. It was killing me.
Did you have a lot of friends who all had gone, they'd undergone their initiation?
No, I hung out with all nerds. I was with the AV squad in high school.
I hung out with
AV.
Nerds too.
We had a little son. It was pathetic.
But hormonally, when you would go home, I mean, you must have been like a jackrabbit jacking off every 3 seconds.
I'm wearing glasses.
Was it a terrible time in your life?
No,
was that the worst part of your life?
No.
Hanging out on the geek squad, so to speak.
I didn't know anything else. You know, I mean, that was it. I got to college. Hey, where's the AV squad? I joined the radio station.
Right.
You know, I remember going down there and hearing the head announcer, this guy, Lee Andrews, and he had this great voice, came down. He was a little shrimpy guy with
hair. He said, this is for me.
I thought, he sounds great. He looks like hell. This is fantastic.
Did you always have an upbeat outlook in terms of, you know, when you're already 20 and you haven't gotten laid?
Yeah.
Because it was such a driving force in my life, do you start to feel bad about your life?
No. I was a nerd. I mean, look, we were.
You're a nerd, but you're a man, and you have a penis. You have urges, hormonal urges.
How did it happen? I mean, now I'm wondering how it ever happened.
I don't know.
Chloroform.
That was it.
Was at the radio station. No, but it must have. See, to me, my whole life was affected by who was into me. You know, I didn't have a lot of friends, so I felt bad about myself.
But women, you couldn't ever say you were an upbeat person. You never looked at the sunny side of anything.
No, I never really
did. Wow, it's good to have friends.
No, but she's right. I never. I remember at five being happy.
Really?
Yeah,
at
and
five.
And then after that, it changed.
It was all
after
downhill from there.
But you were such an upbeat personality.
After five?
But didn't you ever say to yourself in your life, oh, my God, these women are rejecting me. They don't want me.
I figured it had to turn at some point.
Right, and it did in a major way.
And it did.
Yes.
It worked out.
Wow.
It all worked out.
Yes.
Robin rejected me.
Oh, yes. Win.
Never. Never. What is going on over at the Today Show? Now, Meredith Vieira left.
Yes.
Because she needed to be with her family.
Yes.
She needed time off. Yeah. You know, a lot of things going on.
Was it really that, or did she just not like you people?
She didn't like
she
them
hated
because...
She hated us. No.
Because isn't she now appearing on, like, Dateline or one of those shows?
She's going to be on the new Brian Williams show, Rock Center. But, you know, on a limited basis, which is a lot different than getting up every morning, as you know.
Right.
Because for her, she had to get up, like, at 2:30 because she was one of these people that she was afraid she was going to oversleep.
Right.
It was rough for her.
Getting up at 2:30. Is it getting any easier for you getting up? I hate it.
It's never bothered me. I like getting up. I mean, you know, as a kid, my dad was a bus driver, you know, and I used to get up with him. You know, he'd leave at 5 in the morning. So I'd get up with him, and, you know, we'd talk, and we'd have breakfast, and then he'd take off.
Where did you grow up again? What community?
Queens. St. Albans, Queens.
I lived
in Brooklyn for a while, and then Queens.
Primarily a black neighborhood or white neighborhood?
When we moved there, it was a mix, and then we moved in.
You threw the balance off.
It's just complete.
Well, I lived in Roosevelt, Long Island,
sure.
And I remember a black family moved in, and all my friends overnight left. I was the only white guy left.
They didn't tell you.
It was called blockbusting.
That's right, exactly.
It was incredible.
Yep, that's right.
It's and when you're growing up, did you feel like, you mean I moved in and everybody ran away?
Well, it was actually over a few years, you know. But
right.
we had a great neighborhood.
Did you make friends with any of the white people before they left?
Sure.
Before
they
were fleeing?
Last guy I remember, John Hanrahan from St. Catharines, who I've not seen since high school. But hopefully he's still okay.
How do you not grow up bitter racially when you move into a neighborhood and every white person moves away? Do you start to feel like, oh, my God? I mean, it's like, well, what am I, a pariah?
They didn't get it. You know, hey, I'm feeling pretty good.
Right.
Not everybody looks at the world like you, as everything's happening because I did something.
After 5 years old, it all went downhill.
But you understand what I'm saying, yeah?
I do. Yeah. I do. But you know what? Look, the deal was...
Were black people tough on you because you were a geek and you were in the AV squad?
No, because I don't know how it happened, but all the black people around me were geeks too. All my friends were geeks. You know, this
black geeks.
We were, yeah, you know,
wow.
Bleaks.
Bleaks.
Before we knew it, we were bleaks.
So Meredith Vieira, you say, left because of the early morning. She was getting up at 2:30 in the morning,
right,
which has got to wreak havoc on your life.
It's tough.
Yeah. What time did you go to bed last night?
I went to bed around 11, actually.
Oh, I forgot. Dancing with the Stars, I'm sure.
No. My daughter's 13 now, or almost 13.
Right.
And I just can't go to bed before I know she's in bed.
Right.
Asleep. So.
Why is she going to bed so late?
Well, she was off. She's off today.
I see.
She was off from school. I see.
All right.
My 9-year-old, my son, 8:30, he's out. Gone.
You are a good father. With all of the work you do, because people don't know this, you get up early in the morning, you do these weather forecasts and things. Wake up with Al. And then you go out and you produce like 57 shows. Al has more shows than
I know. I can't believe it.
I've never seen these shows. I mean,
Where are they?
I got to listen to this. Al, you are a successful television producer.
I'm trying.
Court TV. There's Al Roker Investigates. He's investigated, kids, cards and dice, faulty forensics. Okay, that's one show. Discovery Health Network, I Lost It, Primetime Special. E! Entertainment, Uncovered, The Hidden Lives of Miss USA. Fine Living, A Perfect Party, Sheila Bridges Designer Living, Swell Girls Holiday, Food Network. Have you heard of these shows?
No.
I mean, you are the most successful unheard of producer in the league.
That's me.
Food Network, you've got... Around the World in New York City, Bahamas Reunion, Big Bad Barbecue Show, Brew Pub, Celebrity Food Fight, Colonial Christmas. An amazing, I would say, 50 shows you have, and no one has seen
these
shows.
Nobody's seen any of them.
How do you keep doing that?
I don't know. Well, those shows, they were on. They're done now.
Oh. Right.
And now, you know, we've got...
You've got a new roster.
We got a new show coming up on A&E.
Are you making any money on these shows?
Yeah, well, we're doing okay.
You're doing all right.
We're doing okay.
Breaking even?
Yeah.
Is that what it is? Is it a lot of nonsense, working and not making any money?
You know, it's fun. I like it.
You like
doing it.
You like producing.
And I like doing stuff that people haven't seen, like this Border Town Laredo show.
Border Town Laredo is the one you're promoting.
Yeah, that's the... It's about the narcotics department at the Laredo Police Department, which is, I mean, they're front line. I mean, right across the river, you got Nuevo Laredo, you got drug cartels, and these guys.
Laredo is in the United States.
No,
Nuevo Laredo is in Mexico.
Yeah. I understand.
And these guys, I mean, it's a small group of really dedicated narcotics officers that are taking down the drug cartels.
Now,
but
these
why
drug-
is the drug cartels are becoming more and more powerful?
Because in Mexico, there's no government there. The government's corrupt. And the drug cartels have actually got so much money. They have their own military.
Yeah.
They have their own guns.
Yep.
Well, how did this happen?
How?
it's money.
It's right. Power.
But my point is, when you see something going on like this, where people could get that powerful, don't you stop it before?
But it's not in our country. It's in Mexico.
Oh, come on.
So these guys are trying to stop it.
You know, don't you feel eventually we're going to have to send troops into Mexico and straighten things up?
That's a possibility.
Yeah, because how's a police force in Laredo supposed to fight the war?
That's a real possibility.
Are these guys in Laredo getting shot and killed and stuff?
No. I mean, they're not. In fact, Laredo is one of the safest cities in Texas.
And probably that's because these cartels know if they fuck with the Americans,
there's going to be trouble.
There's going to be trouble. Then we are going to probably get involved.
Exactly.
Right. So,
but how bad is it for them?
It's tough. I mean, they're not only dealing with drugs, but human trafficking, kidnapping, all this stuff. You know, and people bringing stuff across the border, and it's like every just good police work. They start really low, and the low person on the totem pole, get that person to flip and work their way up.
Well,
I mean, you know,
but you smoke a lot of weed.
You don't want the traffic to stop.
Did you ever try weed?
I did once in college, and I got really like quiet. And I thought, I don't like this.
You're not a drug guy.
No,
you have a couple of drinks.
And I'm so afraid. I was so afraid. Who was the guy? The basketball player, the University of Maryland basketball player, years ago.
Yeah. Len Bias.
Yeah. Right.
I knew I would be Len Bias. Yeah, I would do one thing, my head would explode, my heart would stop immediately, and then
poor Len Bias.
Yeah,
he had a bright future. He went out and did a little coke.
He had just been signed. Right?
He's a strong athlete. He went and did a little coke, and his heart gave out. It was
one of those fear of God moments. I thought, nah, never.
Did you ever cross paths while you were filming this special with Steven Seagal, lawmaker?
I did not see him.
You did not?
No.
Yeah.
No.
What do you think of that?
Well, hey, he's got a job. It's keeping him off the street.
So these guys, for very little pay, go out there and they battle the drug cartels.
Yeah.
And they sit there and they watch and they do surveillance and all that. And we will be getting a first-hand look at this?
The first-hand look Thursday at 10 o'clock on A&E.
And what do you have, a whole production team that goes out there and films these guys for months?
Yeah, we do.
And then you cut it up? And is it a series or is it one shot?
No, it's a series. It's 10 episodes.
So every week I can pretend I'm a lawman.
You can go out with them.
I can go out with them.
That's right. Feel better about your life.
Right. I feel good.
Since you haven't felt good since you were five years old. You're married to one of the most beautiful women in America.
Well, she makes me feel good.
Well, I bet she does. Don't need laughing gas for that.
No. After producing a show like this, did you come to a conclusion that we should just legalize every drug? I'm not a drug guy either, but let's legalize every stupid drug, and that you put the cartels out of business, you put everyone out of business,
but then everybody's all doped up.
But people are going to be doped up anyway.
Well, I don't know about that.
Aren't they?
You think that because we keep some of it out, not everybody's on drugs? You mean everybody will get on drugs?
I think
if the drugs are just there, you think I would go on drugs if they were legal?
Just like that. I think you would turn on a dime.
Would you go on drugs if they became legal?
No.
So neither would I.
There are a lot of people who wouldn't.
There'll be a few of us left, and we'll dominate the world.
Right.
Everyone will be doped up. They'll be like zombies, and we'll be thinking.
We'll be able to run everything.
I'm all for it.
We'll be king of the zombies.
Do you think pot should be legal?
I don't know. You know what? Because I do think there is a, you know, a stepping stone.
You right.
know?
Oh, you think that pot is the gateway drug?
I think it's a gateway drug. I do. I do.
Do you, but most of the pot is now grown in this country, isn't it?
Well, yes and no. I mean, there's some that's being grown. And look, there's also the medicinal marijuana, yeah. which I think is, you know, fine.
But that's a joke. I mean, no one's
everybody
that sick.
In California yeah. has
everybody,
a disease.
Everybody's
now.
Got something wrong.
You know, you're a very conservative guy.
I am. I'm a relatively conservative.
Do you have a comment on gay marriage? Where are you at with that?
I think it's. I believe in, like David Letterman, I think that gay people have the right to be just as miserable as everybody else.
David Letterman believes that?
He said that.
I didn't know that. So you're for gay marriage?
I don't see anything wrong with it.
Do you identify yourself as a Democrat or a Republican?
I don't say. I look at myself as somebody who believes in this country.
Well, what do you think of the Wall Street occupiers?
I think...
He loves them.
I think
he's going to visit.
I think they're terrific. I think they've got a great fashion sense. I think it's one of these things where people have to stop and take notice. This is, you know, there's a movement going on here. You know,
Al, is everyone terrific? In other words, you're smart this way. You're like a politician. You want people to love you. You're the weatherman, a longtime standing weatherman on a show. So in other words, you love the protesters, you love the Republicans, you love the Democrats, you love everybody.
I'm
who is not terrific? Let me start there.
Is there someone?
Who
I like?
I mean, there's got to be someone. Bin Laden, you could have said, but now he's gone.
He's gone.
Although Al's had positive things to say about him.
Bin Laden? Oh my goodness.
He liked the beard.
Not crazy about Gaddafi. Like the outfits. The robes are very nice.
Are there people? Or groups of people like the Tea Party. Do you not like them?
Look, I don't believe in a lot of what they stand for, but I do. I don't look at it as a monolith. I don't. Right. I don't think all Tea Party members are bad people.
But I mean, Al, when you told me in a previous interview that Hitler was misunderstood, I knew that you were really
That's a good guy. He was a bad guy.
But he loved dogs.
And he could paint a room and just right. like that.
And you were the president of the Stalin fan club. That's what a nice guy you are. You like everyone.
Like the statues.
No, but you really, in a way, you cannot allow your personal views. Because you're the weatherman. Think about us. That's crazy.
Not so much about because I'm the weatherman, but I'm on a news show. So, right. you know, you've got to keep that stuff.
Now, what do you think of these news channels that, like Fox News or even MSNBC?
Sure.
They figured out that if all of the news people have opinions,
right.
it will be successful. Could that ever be you? Will you
no,
ever?
No.
You will not do that.
You know what? Because you're going to tick off 50% of your audience.
It is important to you to be loved by everyone.
Not loved by everybody, just watched by everyone.
I mean, everyone loves Al.
But Al makes people feel good.
Look and they go, I look better than this.
Oh, Al has the opposite career mind. I walk into a room, I'm like, who the hell here is going to punch me out? Al walks in, everyone loves him, right? Charles Manson watches Al.
And goes, you know what?
There's a guy I wouldn't go and hurt.
I'm not crazy about him.
That's right. You ready for a few phone calls?
Sure. The big show is called Don't Miss Bordertown Laredo, premiering this Thursday night at 10 o'clock on A&E. You can check out Coast Guard Alaska, premiering November 9th at 9 p.m. on the Weather Channel. And look for Big Easy Justice, coming to Spike TV next year. Yes. Look at you. Wow.
Who knew?
You are on fire.
That's why I need a soothing ointment for that.
Does it bother you that you don't have the big network show, that you haven't produced a big network show
yet? But that's coming.
Are you working toward that?
I'm working toward
it. Are you telling me you have a deal somewhere?
I don't have a deal at this moment, but we're working.
You have an idea.
We have a couple of things in front of the network.
Some shows are only right for cable, like this Laredo show is only...
And the Coast Guard show.
Right. Yeah. Do you have a big idea for a network show where you really cash out?
I have something in front of somebody at NBC right now.
You have something in front of NBC?
Yes, a game show.
A game show. Now that's thinking. Forget all this other nonsense.
And you're going to host the game show?
I may.
You'd be a great game show host.
Have you ever hosted a game show?
I actually hosted Celebrity Family Feud for a couple of years ago during the summer.
Oh, yeah,
I loved that. I loved Family Feud. I loved Richard Dawson.
Listen, Richard Dawson was not good, and I'll tell you why.
Why?
I'm going to give you a tip.
Okay.
If you really get your game show off, all right? I'm a fan of game shows.
Right.
You got two kind of hosts. Mm-hmm. One host who says, you know what? I don't matter. My stupid personality doesn't matter. I'm going to keep the game moving.
Right.
You got these other hosts who think they're Groucho, mm-hmm. and they're going to do, you know, the Groucho is Groucho. Right.
Sure.
To me, a game, like a Family Feud, the reason Richard Dawson was horrible, it became about him. He's kissing. He's carrying on. He's joking. It wasn't even that funny.
It became about him.
Right.
But in the beginning, I thought it was pretty good.
But the game is good. Believe in the game.
Actually, my favorite game show host was Chuck Barris.
Well, he was one of a kind.
Yes.
He really was.
Yes.
But to me, you know who was a great game show host?
Who?
Gene Rayburn.
Gene Rayburn.
Bill Cullen.
Yeah. Yeah,
I got a Gene Rayburn story for you.
Okay.
This was years ago. Deborah and I were walking home. And
your beautiful wife.
Yes, my beautiful wife. We were heading home.
Who makes love to you three times a week, you told me.
At least.
At least. And,
hey, what's another 3 minutes out of
it? Do you make love to her three times a week?
I don't know. Well, yeah, I
you
think
do.
So.
Really?
I think so.
That's impressive.
You know,
all right.
I don't know if she considered that.
Right.
But anyway, we're walking past, and we've been out to dinner, and this guy walks past us. And Deborah says, I think that's the guy from Match Game.
Gene Rayburn.
And I said, Mr. Rayburn? And he turns around. And he says, oh, Al Roker, how are you? I'm a big fan. I said, oh, well, I've been a huge fan of you. And I said, how are you? And he says, and then his face just kind of crumples. And I said, are you all right? And he starts to cry.
Oh, my God.
And he said, my wife just died.
Oh, dear. Wow.
And I thought I was okay, but I'm not. And, you know, we gave him this big hug. And
sad.
6 months later, he died.
Yeah. Wow.
It was really sad. But, he was just and he was so great because of that, you know, matching, just a little smarmy.
Yes,
little,
there was something
little,
going on.
A little smutty,
but his goodness came through.
Yes.
You could see he's a good guy. Any guy who gets that affected about his wife dying, he's got to be a pretty good guy.
It was really sad, but I was always a huge fan of Gene.
So don't get carried, if this game show goes, don't get carried away with your personality.
It's the game.
It's the game.
It's
the game is the thing. Merv Griffin understood this.
Yes.
He was a big producer of game shows.
Yes.
He was a brilliant guy
He really was.
Yeah, Wheel of Fortune. Yeah.
Jeopardy.
I used to love Merv.
All right, let's get to a couple, because you have to leave here literally in 5 minutes to go do today's show.
Are we between breaks or something?
No, I start at 7. I got a little bit past it because I timed it. It only took me 5 minutes to get here. It took about 10 minutes to get past the security guy downstairs.
It's unbelievable. We can't get people in the building. It's unreal.
He goes, hey, Al Roker, I watch you all the time. I said, oh, great, but I can't let you up.
Oh, I know. Okay. We go nuts with that. We have a big problem here.
Wow.
None of our guests can get up. That's the one thing we haven't figured out in the 6 years we've been here.
Fabulous.
How do we get people up? We once had Bon Jovi waiting downstairs. Do you know he left?
Yes, really? I remember that.
He just said, listen, I can't get in.
Get through.
I give up.
I'm Bon Jovi.
Yeah, he goes, I'm Bon Jovi. I'm supposed to be on there. I can't get up to this dude. None of my people out there can
Why
figure out how to get in.
Like
up.
A pneumatic tube.
I don't know how to do it. I don't know how to do it. King of All Blacks is on the phone for Al Roker.
Wow.
Go ahead.
Hey, Al. Yeah, I just wanted to know, is your wife white or black?
She's black.
Oh, snap, that's surprising.
What?
What?
You just come off as you're a nice guy. I love you, man, but you just come off as a person that will have a white wife.
Oh, I see you, because there's a checklist.
Actually,
you have been married to a white woman in the past.
Yes, I was.
You were. And those white people are impossible to live
with. They're crazy.
They really are.
Nutty.
That didn't work out.
No, they smell of mayo.
I know. Well, how long were you married to a white woman?
Seven years.
Horrible?
I knew it.
It was okay.
It was all right.
And then my second wife was black, and Deborah's black.
And Deborah's black.
Yeah.
Three times you've been married.
Three times.
You didn't know that?
Yeah.
You
know,
I forgot.
Al's not that out there. He's a player.
You are a player.
Yeah, just every 7 years.
You think this marriage will last?
We've been married. We just celebrated our 16th anniversary.
Oh, happy anniversary.
Thank you.
That's very nice. All right, King, there's your question.
Let me just ask him one more thing. When you have sex with your wife, dude, or make love to her, whatever you want to call it, what's the freakiest thing you've ever done?
Oh, my.
Al has told me in private, if you don't mind me saying this, he loves to smell feet.
That's right. Nothing like some toe jam.
All right.
Yeah, I like that.
Was it tough for you having white in-laws, when you go home to meet the family?
No, I think they actually liked me more than my own parents.
They did?
No, I'm only kidding. They were lovely. They were lovely people.
All right. Let's go to Aaron, who has a question for Al Roker, who is got another big show coming out, Bordertown Laredo. It premieres this Thursday night at 10 o'clock on A&E. Okay, go ahead, Aaron.
Hi, Aaron.
Hey, now. Hey, I was just wondering if Al's ever offered Stephanie Abrams the brown sausage.
Who's Stephanie Abrams?
Stephanie Abrams is my co-host on Wake Up With Al.
Okay.
At 6 a.m.
Is she attractive?
She's a very attractive
It seems
lady.
To me that these networks find women who are not only bright, but are the sexiest things. When I watch Fox or MSNBC, they're loading up these shows with hot chicks. There's hardly any room left for guys anymore.
No, it's last man standing.
And do you remember when you first got in to the business, It was a mostly guys.
It was. I mean,
club.
In fact, the only time you saw a woman usually was the weather one.
Yeah.
But no. Stephanie and I have a very platonic, professional relationship.
Now, be honest with me.
Yes.
And I know this is going to be a tough question.
Okay.
Okay. Does everyone on the Today Show hate the new chick who took over for Meredith Vieira?
Well, she's been there a while.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Yeah. In this new role, they hate her, right?
No.
That's the buzz I'm getting.
That's other people putting that buzz out.
Yeah.
We love Anne.
You love her?
I love Anne.
But has she changed since she got this role?
No.
No.
In fact, Anne was in my wedding. No.
Is that right?
Yeah. I've known Anne since 1990. I love her.
She was in the wedding.
She was in the wedding. Yeah, she's a good friend of Debra's. You know, the thing about Anne is that, she is, the hardest part for her in taking this job was that she loves being out on the road and doing, real journalism. And, they kind of said, she can do some of that, but it's like,
you're stuck
job,
here.
The job is here.
Yeah.
Has the Today Show, I don't follow this, but have the ratings, do you follow the ratings for the Today?
I do.
Because listen, that's your life.
That's my business.
Have the ratings dropped
the
as a result?
The ratings have not, the news demo, the gap between us and Good Morning America is bigger than ever.
Oh, really?
So you guys are number one.
We're number one. We've been number one for, I guess, 16 years.
Is that important to you to maintain number one? If you dropped to number two even for a week, would it depress you?
I wouldn't. I'd be upset because, you like a streak. You want to stay number one as long as possible. I mean, this is like nobody's ever been number one this long for a television show.
It is phenomenal, isn't it?
I never thought I would be on the Today Show. And then to be on the show and to be part of this run, this phenomenal run of look, you worked in the building. I mean, you're working at NBC. You're the temple of broadcast.
Yes, I remember it was the temple of doom for me.
Well, it was hell for us
for a while. There.
It was a nightmare. Yeah. But you are. It is impressive.
It is,
and the fact that you're part of this winning team is really impressive.
Yeah, I love the job. I love the place. I love the people I work with. And we all respect each other. Look, you can't do this long,
right?
And not get along with the people. You can't fake that. You can't fake that. Nobody's that good an actor.
It's a 5-day-a-week job, right?
5 days a week.
How did you push Willard out? I mean, what was the manipulation there? I mean, how did you finally get rid of him?
Yeah, here's the deal.
Yeah.
Willard, he is literally like my second dad. I mean, I met him in Washington, D.C. when I came to do work at the WTTG, and he was the big mocker.
He's the top guy.
He's it. I mean, he was the biggest thing in Washington other than the president.
Right.
And he took me under his wing. And we jump ahead. I started filling in for him. And he called me one day. He says, listen, brother, here's the deal. He goes, I'm going in. I'm telling him the best time to get out is when you're on top. He goes, I want to get a good deal. I think you should get the gig. I hope they'll give it to you.
Oh, wow. That was generous of him.
You're telling me this because you're under no duress to do this. He goes, nuh-uh. He goes, I want to make the best deal I can. Hang on for as long as I can. I said, okay. And then 2 days later, my agent got the call.
Wow. Willard's still alive?
He's still on the Today Show. He does the 100-year-old birthday.
Right. He's trying to make it to 100, I think.
At least twice.
Are you close with him?
Yeah.
You say close, what does that mean? I know a lot of people in broadcasting,
we talk on a regular basis.
You call him on the phone?
Yeah.
And you say, hey, Willard, what's happening with you? Yeah. How's it going? How long do these conversations last?
5-10 minutes. I mean, sometimes
he dozes off. Yeah, right.
Because I'm boring. No.
No, how old a guy is he?
Willard is going to be 77.
Oh, that's it?
I thought he was a lot older.
Yeah, I thought he was 90.
Look, he was in the control room at WRC. It was a page for NBC the day the Today Show signed on the air.
Wow. So did he leave on his own accord?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
He did. He had it.
Well, he just was tired.
He was burned out.
Well, no, I wouldn't say he's burned out, but he just wanted he wanted to take it easy.
And what does he do with himself all the time?
He's got grandkids. He's got
there with them.
He's got a few houses. In Florida.
Right. I'm going to give you a tough question.
Okay.
Ann Curry and Willard are on a boat with you. The boat starts to sink. They're drowning. You can save one person. I'm being serious now. Would you save Ann Curry or would you save Willard? Seriously.
Well, yeah. I mean, who would
Sophie's
I save?
Sophie's choice.
Wow. That's a tough
who
one.
Who would you save?
I guess I'd have to go with Ann.
You'd save Ann Curry over Willard.
I think I'd have to save Ann because Willard's had a good life. You know?
Yeah, he's lived a long time.
Willard still would like a little more.
I know he'd like a little more.
He's got grandchildren.
He'd like a little more. He's got grandkids, but Ann's got younger kids, and she'd like to see some grandkids.
I'm going to ask you one more tough question.
Okay.
This is tough. This is a great game show, by the way.
This is great.
You sit down a celebrity and say,
who would you save?
Welcome to Who Would You Save with Al Roker. Okay, you ready?
Okay.
It's funny that you, it's interesting to me that you killed Willard, because Willard's the one who rooted for you for the job.
Right.
Yes. Got your career going.
I'm shocked.
Right, but that's okay.
That's what goes to show you.
Right. Teach his own. You're a gentleman.
I don't know.
All right. This is the tough one. Mm-hmm. And don't answer
right away.
Right.
Think it through.
Anne is in the boat again with
you. Okay. She's back in the boat.
Or Meredith Vieira.
Wow.
Okay. Here we go.
Wow.
Fred, some thinking music, please. Let's get back to the game. Who would you save?
I still have to go with Ann Curry.
You'd save Ann Curry over Meredith Vieira.
Meredith left us.
Wow.
Yeah, so. You know.
She left. They're right. Ann's there.
Who has been a part of that 16-year streak? Who have been the anchor?
Matt Lauer.
Matt Lauer's been there the whole time.
He's been there. Yeah, he's been there the whole time.
You think Matt will stay?
Katie Couric.
I hope so.
You do think he'll stay?
I think he will.
You don't think he's had it?
I don't think so. I think he's still having a good time.
He's still having a good. Yeah, you talk to him about this?
Yeah.
Are you friendly? Yeah, you are friendly.
Yeah,
I know that.
Yeah. I mean, I adore the guy. He's he's a gentleman. You know, he really. I mean, you don't. He's really old school.
Didn't you? You did something recently with Michelle Obama, right?
I'm actually going this afternoon. In fact, as soon as I finish the Today Show, I'm flying down. The First Lady and National Geographic are doing this. You know, she has that program. Let's Move.
Right.
If I childhood. Obesity, and they're going to attempt to break the record, the Guinness Book World Record of the most consecutive jumping jacks in 24 hours.
Are you friendly with her?
No, I'm not friendly. I mean, why would she be friendly with me?
I don't know.
I've met her. You know, she's always been very nice to me.
You met the president?
I've met the president.
No kidding.
Yeah.
How did you meet the president?
That's a good deal.
Where do you meet the president?
You know, they have this party, Christmas party.
Yeah.
For journalists and you come.
Oh, is that right?
And you get your picture taken with the president and the first lady.
Are they co-opting you in a way politically when they take you and they give you a photo op of the president? Therefore, they're trying to win you over. They're winning over the media. Is that?
I don't know if they.
Does it bother you?
They did it for. I went down during the Bush years.
Aren't there some there some journalists that won't go do that kind of thing?
There may be, but
does everybody from the Today Show go?
We've all been, yeah.
Ann Curry's not invited.
Ann's been there. It's the President of the United States. Who doesn't want a picture with the President?
No, I mean, I would think it would be tremendous.
You know?
And what do you say to this guy?
Hi, Mr. President.
Yeah.
Nice to see you.
That was it? There's no conversation.
He's always like, how's the weather? He's something about that.
Oh, hey, give me
how's
weather.
How's the weather? Everybody asks you.
And you're like, well, why don't you stick your head out the window? I don't know.
You got a lot of windows here. Come on.
That's right.
Really, come on.
All right, listen. Al Roker is the very successful. Are you the most successful weatherman in the country? I would say so, right? You're on the number one morning show.
I guess so.
Huh? Yeah. I mean, more people turn to you for weather than anyone. Yeah,
but Sam Champion's better looking.
All right, here we go. Don't miss Border Town Laredo.
Yes.
Al, in addition to his five other jobs, is now producing this show. It premieres.
How much of your time does this producing take?
Yeah, I mean, I'm at the production company a good 4 or 5 hours every day.
Is that right?
Yeah, look at the rough
during the week. You ever see the kids?
Yeah, I get home. I mean, I try to get home. I usually get home a couple of days in time to pick my son up from school.
You do,
and then I make dinner.
And then you go to bed at what? 8 o'clock?
No, about 9:30, 10.
No kidding. Yeah. And what do you operate on, 5 hours of sleep?
Yeah, 5, 6 hours.
Wow.
Yeah.
Are you exhausted on the weekends?
Yeah, but, you know, you just keep moving.
Do you have energy? Do you have any kind of energy on the weekend, or do you just pass out?
Yeah, no. I mean, in fact, I'm training for a triathlon, so I just...
Now you're going, oh, my God, you're out of your mind. Wasn't that marathon enough?
Do you think you have a nervous energy of some kind?
No, I just, you know...
What are you so nervous about?
You know, it's not nerves. It's like I feel like I need a goal, you know, to stay in shape. And so, you know, I just keep...
Sounds like an incredibly busy life between family and that job and then the producing job and then
the
triathlon.
Well, once again, you have to think of Jeff the Drunk. We were talking about this the other day.
Right,
how
who
this
has no
guy
motivation.
Does nothing.
Right,
and then you have Al on the other end of the scale.
Well, you know, I mean, it's look.
Your mom was Jamaican, right?
Yes, she was.
Well,
that explains everything.
My dad was Bahamian.
Yeah, well, that explains because the Jamaican people are the hardest working.
They
people.
Have built many jobs.
That's right.
Right.
Many jobs.
You're slacking off, you lazy bones. You only have two jobs.
Yeah, two jobs is ridiculous.
You got nothing.
Listen, was it weird having a Jamaican mother in the sense that? I lived in the black community longer than you.
Mm-hmm.
Jamaicans and American blacks do not get along.
Here's the deal. No, my mom was most people, if you heard her, you would have sworn I was raised by a Jewish woman.
Right.
You know, she had this sound. People thought, is your mother white? Is she Jewish? And I said, no, she's not. But right. We lived in Canarsie for a while, and I think it rubbed off.
It's a tough neighborhood, Canarsie.
Yeah, well, it was then. But right. It wasn't. We were in the projects, you know, which at the time was predominantly Jewish. You know, so.
Right. So there you go. All right. Listen, I don't know what we proved today.
Nothing.
Right.
You were miserable after 5.
That's what Al learned.
I remember feeling elation at 5 years old, like this weird feeling of waking up happy, and then it died.
It went away. That was it.
And then puberty hit, and I started looking like this, and I just remember being miserable. I was like, how did this happen? I was such a cute kid.
It was like the nuclear winter, you know? Yeah. Oh, look at that.
See,
beautiful mushroom.
You know, the worst time of my teen years was when it was on NBC. It was a Thursday night. And they debuted as a special, the Bill Cosby Fat Albert Show.
Right.
My first name's Albert.
Right.
So it was not fun.
And those were fat. The bad years.
Fat. Walked into St. Catherine at the end of the schoolyard.
Oh, you mean every day you got hey.
Oh, yeah.
And the kids called you Fat Albert.
Fat Albert.
Oh,
did you ever tell Bill Cosby that?
I did. He didn't care.
Yeah.
But here, have a pudding pop.
It's amazing that you are so positive. When you were really obese,
right.
When you'd watch yourself on TV.
I didn't watch myself.
You didn't? Because it was too painful.
It was
you were like, I look horrible. Right.
Yeah.
Do you watch yourself now?
I do.
You're in love with yourself.
Constantly.
Right.
I love me.
No, seriously. I mean, you got to feel good about it.
I do.
During those years, Al, you were still the jolly guy. So right. Was that like a facade?
It was all horseshit.
No, it wasn't. I just didn't watch me. You know?
Did you ever have a fist fight with kids when they started to call you Fat Albert and things?
Only one kid, Stephen Roach.
And how was the outcome of that fight?
I grabbed his tie and kind of went like that, and he started to choke. And the nun, the sister, I don't know if it's sister Noella, had to go run and get scissors while this kid was flopping around on the floor.
You almost killed him.
Yeah, I got called into the office. It was ugly.
Why did you get into a fight with him? Because you called you Fat Albert?
Well, he was always picking on me, you know, because I was fat. And
right.
I was kind of,
and you finally
put him down. So it was that bullying thing.
I snapped.
You stood up for yourself.
I snapped.
Fascinating. I got to go find that kid. All right, listen.
The kid who was choked out by Al Roker.
Right.
The one kid.
Al, listen, I know you got to get to the Today Show.
Oh, yeah.
I understand that. Don't miss Bordertown Laredo premiering this Thursday night at 10 o'clock on A&E. That's
Thank you. First
message. Check out Coast Guard Alaska premiering November 9th at 9 p.m. on the Weather Channel. And look for Big Easy Justice coming to Spike TV next year.
All right.
Well, it's that production company that keeps
They're rolling them out.
Impressive. The great Al Roker, the Today Show. Say hello to all my friends
at
NBC.
Including Willard.
Please do.
Yeah. Been thrown off the boat.
I'd love to go stare at the wall with Willard one day, if you don't mind.
Well, when Willard hears that he's drowning,
I don't know how that next conversation's going to go.
Know.
I'll let you know.
I can't wait to hear those phone conversations. You got to tape those. It's got to go something like this.
Hello.
Oh, hello, Willard. It's Al.
Hello.
Al Roker.
Oh, hello, Al.
Stop it.
What's going on?
Stop.
Nothing. We're here.
What are you doing?
With the grandkids.
Oh, great. What a fucking conversation that must be. You must go out of your mind.
He's enjoying it. Why can't you let him have his joy?
I don't know. Well, anyway, Steve Roach, Meredith Vieira, and Willard are downstairs waiting to talk to you because you drowned them all in a boat.
Take them out, baby.
All right. Al Roker, everybody. We'll be back right after these words.
Here's public radio personality Ira Glass on Letterman.
Now let's talk a bit about radio. You're one of these guys who has gone a long way, really, to revitalizing radio by making it something fresh and different. And there must have been people when you were a kid that had a big influence on you the way you are now influencing others.
As I've gotten older, I'm a huge Howard Stern fan.
Right, sure.
I love. And when I say that to public radio audiences, yeah, thank you, Howard Stern fans. Public radio audiences, they always get a little chilly when they
really?
Yeah, they don't understand it. Though there's an overlap. Like every day on the radio station where I work, every day there's 8% of our audience is flipping back and forth between Morning Edition, NPR's show, and Howard Stern. Mm-hmm. So we are not Legion, but there are some of us besides me flipping back and forth.
The Howard Stern Show.
Our freedom is under assault, and unless we recognize these attacks for what they are, and speak out. No, shout out.
Raise your fist.
Then we are doomed to wake up one sad morning and wonder when and where our freedom died.
The Howard Stern Show.
Uh-huh, it's the bad guy, Trick Daddy Artist, and I fuck with my nigga, DJ Smell So Good. Uh-huh.
Every time I had my co-host on, I used to rag the shit out of it. She was like, we gonna drink that piss shit down here. They don't even have that shit here. You know what I'm saying?
Yo, 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 man, what up?
I heard you come through the phone, Rich.
What be happening, bro?
Yo, yo.
Yo, 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 yo.
You punk ass motherfucker call into my goddamn show.
What's going on, bitch? We're a couple of gay black brothers, man. Let's talk brother to brother.
Yo, motherfucker, you gonna give me some big old black dick to suck on or what, bitch?
Let's get gay, man.
Hey, first of all, how do you know I'm black, man? How do you know I'm black?
Hey, as long as you got a cock I can suck, man.
Dude, that's not cool to call it to my homeboy show, man. Okay, that's fucking like rude, man.
Yo, this is his husband, man. I'm fucking him in his white ass right now, wishing for your big black dick to come down my gullet, motherfucker.
Yo, man.
I'll pull my big black dick out of your big black ass.
Are you fucking hearing me, dude? Okay.
I've been listening, man. Go ahead.
I'm fucking coming rain on you, man. I will shit on your parade, man.
I love to be shit on, man.
You fucking know.
I want to be shit on.
Fucking, hey, babe. We're for a fucking fight.
I got my butthole spread right now.
Shit on your parade, man.
I want you to shit in my mouth.
Goddamn fag.
I
George Harrison. Oh, and Robin is singing along. Good for you, Robin.
Fabulous. Was loving it.
Yeah. This is so great. I love when people... You know, who doesn't know Mike Hunt? When you see that name, Mike Hunt, that it's Mike Hunt. You know what I mean? So here's a city council meeting in Los Angeles. And the city, they're calling some sort of roll call and stuff. I don't know what they're doing, but Mike Hunt is
one of the people they call.
This is the greatest.
Highlands.org, thank you. Free public promotion there. Mike Hunt in the audience?
How did they get that in there?
It says Mike Hunt here, not here. Dr. Tom Williams.
They're like doing a roll call.
Right. I guess they have to call people in the audience, and somebody put that out there, and he called him a lot of times.
Mike Hunt? Mike Hunt?
Mike Hunt not in the audience?
Mike Hunt.
Highlands.org, thank you. Free public promotion there. Mike Hunt. Mike Hunt? Mike Hunt in the audience? Michael Hunt? It says Mike Hunt here, not here. Dr. Tom Williams.
Let's go. Let's move on.
Is there someone rolling around in life?
John Lieberman's here with the headlines from the Howard 100 newsroom. This guy works his ass off. If you're doing something wrong, he's going to find out. So just give yourself up right now. This guy's a hard-working, hard-hitting journalist. Yes, John.
And we begin this morning with breaking news. The situation at Bigfoot's Vermont apartment very much deteriorating. You see,
By the way, I heard a report from Howard 100 News with an actual interview with Bigfoot.
How could it be deteriorating? Isn't it horrible already?
Well, Bigfoot used to play, you know, Bigfoot has a subscription to Sirius.
Yes.
And he started playing our show because he played it loud out his window because he felt he was doing the community a favor. He says, everyone wants to hear Howard, and Well, the cops came, you know, and there was a thing, and he's completely depressed. That's what I know.
Well, he's facing eviction now because not only does he blare the Howard Stern show, he does it from a huge speaker on the porch, and his neighbor happens to be a child care center.
Oh.
So many parents have called the landlord complaining of vulgarities coming from Bigfoot's porch.
Right.
Instead of simply bringing in the speaker inside and listening to it a little quieter, Bigfoot says he won't even listen to the show anymore.
And Bigfoot is so stubborn. That I heard him on the interview. It was a hard-hitting interview done by the Howard 100 News team. And he was just like, I don't give a fuck about the child center. I mean, he's on fire.
He doesn't get it at all.
No, it's great.
Well, he's fired up also because, you see, after having sex twice with his live-in housekeeper, he proposed to her.
Right.
Getting down on one knee, giving her two rings. She thought about it for 8 hours, then declined, so he fired her and kicked her out. And later found that she is sleeping with one of his friends now.
Why did Bigfoot ever explain why he gave her two rings? Did anyone ask?
Yes, of course we asked, Howard. Right. Of course. And he thought that it was appropriate to display his love with multiple pieces of jewelry.
Right. Now, we know he has zero money. He's on public assistance. First of all, how does he afford a housekeeper? And secondly, how does he afford two rings, let alone one ring?
I'll answer the second question first. He has started running a pawn shop out of his apartment where he's selling televisions, chainsaws, and CD players.
Right.
And single cigarettes for 50 cents a cigarette.
Wow.
So that's how he's generating some income.
Right.
Also, he's using some government assistance through a loophole to help pay for his live-in housekeeper.
All right. Okay.
So he is facing eviction.
So will he be looking for another housekeeper to have sex with?
Yes. The search has begun for another housekeeper. She took the internet tower out of his apartment, so he's thinking about placing an ad in the newspaper since he doesn't have access to the internet now.
Tell me something about Howard 100 Newsroom, because I'm fascinated. Now, Bigfoot is, in other words, you just joined the newsroom fairly recently. How does it work? You walk in the morning, and who decides who's covering Bigfoot? Who decides who's covering what? And is there a chart of, like, who are the more important people to cover? Like, that we have to check in on Bigfoot because he's key guy.
I wouldn't say there's a hierarchy, a chart, if you will, but Brad Driver, the news director, kind of gives marching orders, and then we all just kind of, you know, work
you
our beat. Shuley with the Whack Packers generally, Lisa right. Celebrity, me, you know, digging a little bit into things. Right. It just so happened I started with Bigfoot one day. Now I check in with him every day because every day it's something else.
Right. It's huge. It's news.
So it's, you know, and it really is. I mean, you
who
know.
Are your five go-to people when it's a slow news day and you say, I've got to dig up something? Bigfoot, obviously, one of them. Who would be the other people, the other candidates?
They're like gold mines.
I think there's easy fodder with Bigfoot, with Riley, with JD. I think Jason Kaplan is always a good source of
right?
of information or right. to comment on something because he always wants, you know, to
Jason
be out
has
there.
A lot of opinions. So does JD, right.
Whatever yeah. happened to that gossip thing that JD and not JD, Jason and Will used to do?
Yeah, well, that you know what? You know, it's funny. When Andy Rooney retired, they did in a retrospective of his career. I remember before there was Andy Rooney, there was Shayna Alexander arguing the liberal point of view. It was point-counterpoint
yeah.
with, I forget the guy's name. Some things come and some things go. In other words, they run their course.
Well, I thought it was because it made so much trouble around here.
I think that had a lot to do with it. Whatever happened to that feature, Gary?
The guys were just telling me Langford put an end to it.
Wow.
He refused to read the stories because they didn't have a source.
Well, he's right.
But that's
okay,
gossip.
That's gossip.
When you go to page six and they do
yeah,
a blind
but they
item.
They do have a source.
Well, we have a source, too. We just don't say what it is.
I see.
It's a blind item.
Right. Langford had that much power that he could kill a story?
He wouldn't read them.
Wow.
We absolutely had sources. But what he would do is, Brad Driver would write for him the headlines to come to read, and Steve would sit there and he'd investigate our stories before he'd come in the air to read the stories.
Right.
So all of a sudden, our stories were getting double investigated, and I was like, forget it. What are we doing this for? For you to be up our ass every morning questioning everything we do?
Well, you know what? I like this better. I like that you got a guy like Lieberman who hears your gossip and then goes and investigates. I'm more comfortable.
Yeah, and I like to write my own headlines because I like to check out the information. I don't want to come in here and say, you know, something that isn't fact.
We never made a story up, and I once we put the story out there, investigate it all the way. I love
what
that.
What was your biggest story that you guys
released? Sal on the megaphone. That was page 69.
That Sal used the megaphone.
Yeah. That was the one. We reported that one. I thought you were going to fire Sal. I felt really bad about it.
That was a hard-hitting story. That was good. That was good stuff. You remember that one, John? Have you heard about that?
I have heard about that
right,
one,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, real important you. Stuff you're missing.
A couple other things. The love affair between Chuck Zito and Charlie Sheen is over.
Uh-oh. Oh, my God. Did you hear Chuck's
over.
Show?
Over. No.
Did you hear Chuck's show?
Absolutely.
Chuck's show is the best show on the
when
channel.
When was Chuck's show on?
Last night.
Last night. I missed it.
I can play a clip if you want.
Please.
It's worth hearing Chuck talk about Charlie.
Yeah, it's hard to believe. It's hard to believe.
I went out there just to go to the roast.
Yeah, I know.
Right? With Charlie Sheen. So what happened... 3 weeks before, I was in California for a month with him. I was bodyguarding him. I was training him every day. We were getting up 6:30 in the morning. I was teaching him how to box, a little martial arts, doing everything. Took him to took all his meetings for with Lionsgate for the show. And
wow. I mean, Chuck was like...
He was
in. He was keeping the guy together. Boy, I wish they had videotaped all of that.
Let me see that. I mean, you're saying that he was a minder. He would stay with Charlie all day long
Chuck was there.
And take care of him.
He would wake up at 5 in the morning and train Charlie. They were doing boxing, taekwondo.
Yeah.
He was getting Charlie into shape.
Chuck continues.
We did actually the last time I did the radio show, we did it live from Pete's house, and Charlie Sheen was my guest.
That wasn't long ago.
I went home. I come back 3 weeks later. I went out there just for the roast, and it was his birthday a week before. So Charlie loves baseball. Yeah. I went online. I found a 60-year-old trophy. Well, almost. Well, the trophy's probably 60 years old, but it was given to somebody in 1953. So I had all the plaques made for it. It had a solid copper cup and everything. It was beautiful, beautiful. I had everything engraved to him. I go down to his house,
right?
And his assistant there, Rick, meets me at the front. And he goes, look, Charlie says you should call first before you come. He's in a meeting. I said, since when did I ever fucking have to call Charlie to come to his house? And I was staying there, right? And he goes, well, things changed. I said, what, in 3 weeks? So I said, okay, do me a favor. Just give him this for, you know, gift. His gift. Say happy birthday. Figured he'd call me. Never heard from him.
Well, that wasn't all. I mean, then Chuck shows up at the roast.
Right.
And holy cow, what happened was a terrible, terrible treatment of Chuck Zito. Listen to this.
Went to the roast 3 days later. Now you got to realize the stage is there, right? And you got table one, two, three, four. It goes all the way around, all the way in a circle, all the way in a circle. And it goes all the way back to table 87. That was like, you might as well go across the street and watch the fucking thing, right?
Right.
I get there. No tickets. They give me one ticket.
Listen to this.
Table 87 all the way in the fucking back.
That's disrespectful.
And I went fucking crazy, man. I fucking went berserk. I said, I might as well go cross street on the roof and look through the window. I would have had a better fucking view. And I went ballistic, man. I walked up there. I said, where's his fucking manager, his agent, this and that? What's the matter, Joe? What's the matter? They put me all the way in the fucking last fucking row, man. You know? And people he just met were on the front. You know, just fucking totally, totally fucking.
Yeah, like what the fuck happened?
Totally fucking insulting and disrespecting me, man. And I said, fuck this fucking roast, man. I fucking left in front of all those people before it even started.
I said, oh, you did?
Yeah, fuck that. I wasn't going to fucking, because they couldn't find them. And he was getting ready to go on stage and all. I said,
did he at least call you after that?
Nope.
No, huh?
Nothing.
Nope.
Wow.
So I said, what the fuck? You know, what's up his ass? So,
Charlie Sheen really is crazy.
It's amazing, man. How close you with somebody for all those years. 18 years I know the fucking guy.
And you just left him. He just did the fucking show.
And something happened. I don't know what the fuck happened. So who knows what's going on. But never paged me, never nothing.
And by the way, Chuck's co-host is more upset than Chuck is.
I paged him. I said, hey, you know, at least say thank you for the fucking gift, this and that. So he pages me and he texted me like a week later.
Oh, he did.
Or 2 weeks later, probably 2 weeks later. And he says, since when was the roast about you? Meaning me.
Meaning
right?
You.
Yeah.
You must have hit him hard when you worked out.
Forget about
him.
It, man. Forget about
you
it.
Must have heard him.
So I says, it came about me when your fucking staff insulted and disrespected me. And I text back. And I said, first of all, I don't fucking text. You know that. If you want to sit down and talk like fucking men, let's fucking do it. Never heard from him.
Didn't want that man talk.
Scumbag.
I don't know. No, he ain't. He's a good guy, but
I'm not saying he ain't a good guy.
I don't know.
You're saying he's a scumbag. And, you know, listen, the friend is sticking up for Chuck.
Well.
The show is a great show, and I'll tell you why. You know, Chuck just doesn't paint his life all the good stuff that's happening. He tells you when he is disrespected. And he lets you know. And let me tell you something. That's painful for Chuck. That one thing he loves is to be respected.
That's all he lives for.
Right.
So, every day he needs to have respect all day long.
He's sharing his humiliation with you.
Absolutely.
And that's a good broadcast.
That this is a guy, he considers him a friend. Right. He's been standing there. Remember, he said he even saved the show.
Right.
He figured out that Charlie should have somebody sit there and ask him questions.
That's right.
And oh, so he's home. Been there for Charlie.
This is bullshit.
A scumbag, he's my friend.
Well, you know? I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't
but,
do that.
But I don't know what happened to him. All I know is I went home 3 weeks later as a fucking totally different guy, man. I said, what the fuck? I'm still surprised.
Yeah,
I
right.
said, at least text me. Tell me. You know, first of all, it's texting like pussy shit. I mean,
right,
call
yeah.
the fucking guy on the
phone. Yeah, real men don't text.
Real men don't know how to work a smiley face button.
Something, you know.
Yeah.
And fuck. I says I had to text back because he don't fucking call. So I text back and
I mean you've seen Chuck's hands. He's got these big hands. Can you imagine him trying to text?
Yeah, there's no keyboard, no virtual keyboard. Nothing will fit him.
I see him doing it because the phone breaking underneath his thumb.
He's got one of those bricks of a phone too. He doesn't. It's an old time phone.
Oh, so he's got to really hit a lot of buttons.
Oh yeah,
he's a big guy.
At least tell me what the fuck you know. Your problem is never heard from him. So. And I wrote back because I was supposed to move there. Remember?
Yeah,
I was getting up and move my cars every fucking there.
Oh, yeah.
And you were moving
come
in
out
with
there.
Charlie?
We're doing the show. I'm putting you on 100 episodes.
Oh.
I'm giving you points for the show that'll work $2-3 million. And I said, great, great. Boom. So I wrote back. I says, well, I take it I'm not working on the show anymore. So never heard from him.
Right.
So there goes that fucking plan out the window.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, I was ready to fucking imagine if I moved out there and he did that.
Wow.
I'd have to fucking crack somebody. But
thank goodness he didn't move.
It's fucking just weird, man. Yeah. Fucking weird. Really blew me away.
Well, Chuck,
I'm still stunned by it. I don't know what the fuck.
If I can give Chuck any consolation, in the world of Charlie Sheen,
3 weeks from now, he could forget all that and then be
your
best friend.
You'll be back in.
Right, yeah. So don't worry. You'll be back. What else you got there, John?
Speaking of shows on the channels, the conditions at Riley Martin's home studio, sources tell us, deteriorating. We have learned cockroaches have been seen climbing on the equipment. A fly strip is now hanging. The problem, a second cat has been introduced into the mix. So cat fur has been covering the fly strips. Riley's producer, Eron, denies that the working conditions are unsafe, even invited me out there for myself. Into Jersey to see the conditions for myself. Meantime, though, Eron does confirm to me what my sources were telling me. He's helped Riley put together a multi-page proposal sent to Sirius XM execs outside the Stern channels, lobbying for a show on a different Sirius XM station.
Good. Well, I hope, been trying to tell him to do that for a long time.
I hope he we don't lose him, though. You know, and then we have to fill that programming hole. What else?
He's long suspected, Howard, that he would be more welcomed at another channel.
Right.
Scott the Engineer has once again been approached by the Professional Bowlers Association to play in their upcoming World Series of Bowling tournament. Scott, sources say, is trying to drum up support around the Stern channels via emails to send him to compete again.
You know what?
What are these emails? Who's he sending them to? Did he
please.
Send you an email?
You know what? So about a month ago, Gary comes to me and he says, or Doug Goodstein came to me, actually,
okay,
you know, from Howard TV. And he said, hey, you know, Scott's been asked to go bowl again, the PBA tour. I said, yeah. He goes, well, you know, last year we covered it on Howard TV, and, you know, what do you think? Do you want to do it again? You know, Scott approached us. He'd be interested. I said, look, let me think about it. So I'm thinking about it. I go, you know, from what I remember, I watch Howard TV.
It wasn't that big.
It wasn't that interesting to begin with. Scott stands there like a lummox and bowls, and he bowls okay. He didn't do great. He didn't do bad. He just was,
he was just
boring.
Okay.
It was fine for what it was. I wasn't sitting in pining away for Scott to go back on the
PBA tour.
Yeah,
you haven't been thinking about it.
Yeah, well, Scott's been thinking about it.
Well, he had a great
time. Right, he had a great time. And don't forget, he left here for like a week or two, and no one missed him. And that's a big, that's problematic when you leave and nobody knows you're gone, because it makes it seem like you're not that valuable. So then, Scott, so I said to Doug Goodstein, I think we'll pass on it this time.
Scott!
I said, I don't see the merit in it.
Right.
Well, next I guess they told him no. And Scott's sort of having an inner tantrum. He writes me a direct email.
Ah.
And he goes, I don't know if you are aware of this, but the PBA has asked me to bowl again on their tour.
So, in other words, he got the no from Doug.
He got the no from Doug. Now he's writing me.
And he wants to get a direct no from you.
I didn't even write him back. Never responded to his email, right? I never responded, and I never fucking will. So then I write Gary.
Wait, that's rude. Okay.
Oh, good.
That's really rude.
And you're rude.
No, I'm not rude.
You were told no by Doug Goodstein.
I wasn't told no. I never got an answer. That's the problem.
Well, you're
rude.
I
never got an answer.
All right.
So I'm not rude.
First of all, you don't
ask me. I ask a question around here, and people freak out. What the fuck is that?
You don't ask me that.
I don't.
You don't bother me. When do you ever write me?
Yeah.
Don't bother me.
Wow.
You
who the fuck
me?
Are you not to bother you?
I'm your boss.
Yeah, I know that, but I can't ask you a question?
Right? No.
Holy
no.
Shit, what
you
the fuck
can't.
Is wrong with you?
Because you know around here you go to Gary.
Wow.
You don't come to me directly.
Well,
because you were already
I
told
I did, but
no.
I never got an answer.
Doug Goodstein told you no.
No, he didn't.
Yes, he did.
He's coming in
right now.
Now, he's going to, listen.
But this is what gets him worked up, the bowling. Not the wife calling in. He could care less.
That's another fucking issue.
So, Doug, here's my issue
Mr. Trader over here. Throw anybody under the bus he can.
Here's my issue with you.
Doug, you never gave me an answer.
After I wrote no to you, Doug, what happened? Did you tell him no?
I said he took.
He said he never got an answer
Howard
from you.
I got a weird vibe from Howard. He didn't seem really into it. I followed up with an email to you.
Right.
Didn't hear back.
It was fine.
Scott,
yeah, so
did I not
so
tell
Doug,
you?
So listen. Scott knows around here. You don't bother me with your shit because I don't like saying no to anybody.
That's right.
And you go. Yeah. That's what you.
So
were,
say
you
no.
Were,
because, instead of a no answer.
No. You go to Gary like you do on everything.
I do go to Gary.
Do you ever write me once asking
Gary,
me about your job?
Gary
you
never came back to me.
Do you ever ask me about what you should be doing every day in your studio? No. You
Gary never
Gary.
Came back to me.
You want a bowl so bad you're throwing a tantrum.
Well, I'm not throwing a tantrum.
So listen to this. This is what matters.
Listen.
Wait. I'm not done.
So then Scott doesn't hear back from me. Because he knows what that means. I don't write to Scott about his personal bowling. We have meetings for that. Gary, he has a conduit to go to Gary. You can go to Doug Goodstein. And when he hears that Howard's not interested, take the fucking hint.
No, okay, fine. Don't cover it for Howard TV. That's fine. Okay.
Then he gives up on me. Tim comes to me.
Ah, he went to Tim.
Oh, he's going to everybody.
Came to me.
Right.
And then we discussed it, and I said to Tim.
So Gary then comes to me. So Scott knows what to do.
So you're still getting questions.
Well, wait a second. In between Gary, I walk by Scott's studio, and Scott says to me, you know, I want to go bowling, something along those lines. So I had just come off the air. My head was fucking spinning. So I go, oh, I said, you know, quite frankly, I was thinking about it. If there was any merit in it, if there was anything good for Howard TV or on the radio.
So you're still considering it.
Yeah, I was thinking about it.
Just don't bother
you. I was thinking about it, but he's bothering me as soon as I get off the air. Because he wasn't satisfied that I didn't answer his email. But he's already gotten a no from Doug. Gary, he went to. So Gary comes to me, and I said, you know what, Gary? I like Scott. I got nothing against him. He wants to bowl. Let me think about this. I sat in my office and wasted 20 minutes of my time trying to think if there's any fucking reason I need this guy. And I still was saying, oh, what the hell? So then, I don't know, Gary then, I talked
about it. We discussed it, and then you said, you know what? We need him here. Right. So then Scott had come to me and I said...
Yeah, I mean, he's got a job.
But I said, you should talk to Tim. So Tim sat him down and said, no. Did Tim tell you no?
Nope.
What did he say to you?
Tim
Nobody
told me
will
you
tell
you
no.
What did Tim say to you?
Tim came to me and said, as a friend, and first of all, he's not my friend.
Okay.
I'd like to give you advice. All right.
What was his advice?
Drop the bowling issue.
Well, that's... Okay. So what is that
saying? So what happened?
That's... Officially, that is not an answer.
Scott, I told you that 3 weeks before Tim told you that.
I said, everyone's nicely saying to you, no one cares if you bowl.
I dropped the bowling issue.
Well, then he comes up with a new plan. He goes, I want to take my personal time. So I get a memo from Tim and Gary. Scott is now saying he wants to take his personal time to go bowling. I said, you mean when he has his vacation, it coincides with bowling. I said, that's fine
with
me.
Well, unfortunately, it doesn't coincide.
Right.
Unfortunately for you.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I'm...
Right. So I go, that sounds okay to me. I go, you mean during his vacation? They go, no. He wants to take his own vacation, set up his own vacation, and go bowling.
Uh-huh.
I go, well, is he needed here? Because if he's not needed here, why is he here anyway? I said, do you guys need him here? They go, yeah, we need him. So I said, well... Then there's no issue. Forget the fucking bowling. I want to go shoot pictures today for my photography.
What I could be doing today that I don't wanna, mean,
Scott,
you mean I wouldn't be here?
The only reason they're asking you to bowl is because you're on this show. Leave the show, quit the show, and go off and become a professional bowler. What are you waiting for? What are you doing? You're nuts. You're going to go campaign? You see how hurt he is? This matters to him more than anything.
I was trying to get an answer from somebody.
What do you think the answer
is? You got an answer.
Three guys told you, drop the issue.
I love it that he says Tim is not his friend. Tim tries to give him some friendly advice.
Right.
And Tim says drop it. And
okay.
He goes, that's
so
an official
I didn't
answer.
So the show, you don't want to cover it? That's fine. They
right.
still...
We don't want to cover it. Nobody cares when you bowl.
They... Good. That's fine.
Unless you're bowling Wendy
Do
the
you
Reader.
Feel like you have an answer now? Or do you need me to like sit down with you?
Well, obviously you don't want me to go, so that's the answer. You gave me the answer.
Listen...
Listen, give me the answer.
I want you to have everything in life you should have.
I get it.
But you got a job. Listen, you're not 12 years old.
No, I'm not 12.
You got a job.
Okay, so...
Either you're needed, you asked around. I said, does anyone need Scott here? They told me yes. I was shocked.
Oh, wow.
As much as you are.
Yeah, right.
Isn't it nice that people need you?
Very nice.
So that's more important than going to fucking bowl. What is it?
Is there some free time you have that you could participate in this a little bit?
No, unfortunately, it happens during a week that the show's here.
Oh.
3 days, you know.
Well, there you go.
So
there's your answer. You can't bowl.
Okay.
Wow.
I got an answer.
Right.
I was looking for an answer.
You didn't have an answer.
You got five answers.
You got 20 answers from 20
Doug
people.
Doug never gave me an answer. Gary never gave me an answer. You never gave me an answer.
What did Doug say to you?
Off the record.
Doug said, we're not interested. Tim said, hey, drop the bowling issue. No one's interested. Gary said to you, it's not going to happen.
Okay, so fine.
What answer were you looking for? As far as writing me, the one time you wrote me a personal note is to ask about bowling. I don't know whether you're needed around here for bowling. It's an outrageous question. I don't have anything to do with that. Gary around here answers all of your questions.
Okay.
That's the pack. All of a sudden, you break protocol around here, but I'm bowling. Meanwhile, you got the answer from 20 guys.
I went to Doug first. I didn't go to you.
You went to Doug.
And
you
gave you an answer.
Doug showed interest, and he said it would be a good follow-up.
Right. Okay,
that's Doug.
And I told Doug he's out of his fucking mind.
Because we do the behind-the-scenes show now, it'd be more...
Scott. It's boring.
Okay.
Watching you bowl is like watching paint dry.
You get it.
My fans who pay for Howie TV don't want to sit and look at your fucking bowling.
I get it.
I know this. Listen, I'm sorry. I want to do something today. I don't want to be here today.
So
what
then,
should I do?
Who am I going to cry to? Really? Then I was just asking for some personal time off. 3 days.
Listen to me. Personal time. I want personal time.
Oh, my God. You really do?
Yeah.
Okay, you still don't get enough?
Scott, can I have... No, I don't. Really? I want more personal time. Can I have it?
You can have... Obviously,
you're laughing about my personal time.
Yeah.
Your personal time matters. Mine doesn't.
I didn't say it doesn't, but...
Personal time. I said to Gary, I never heard this around here. What is personal time?
It's vacation time that I get from the company.
Wait a second. I said, if it's Scott's vacation, of course he can have it.
Well, it's vacation time.
But I heard that you have scheduled vacation. It's not, right? And Gary explained this. Explain it to him again.
Okay. Vacation time is vacation time that you get. We've all agreed, since we've all worked here, that we all take vacation together. Otherwise, it's anarchy.
And I do that.
Personal days... You know what personal days are for. You're like a factory worker, but you know better. Personal days are for a funeral, a family emergency.
Not to bowl.
That's not a personal day.
That's why I was asking if it would be...
They told you no. I know they told you no.
I explained what I got. The answer
is. What do you think the answer is? Did anyone say yes?
No one said yes.
Did anyone say it was a good idea? Did anyone say, I think this might work? Tim said to you, I would drop this if I were you, Scott. Your boss, your direct boss, said, I would drop this.
Listen, I got news for you. I'm going to give you some advice. As your friend, I consider myself a friend of yours. Maybe not Tim.
Maybe you don't consider him a friend.
The kind of passion you have for this bowling is the passion you should have for when my equipment breaks.
I do.
Okay. That's what you should be excited about. Forget bowling. Bowling is for going once a week with your friends. You get a little drunk, get away from the wife, and you sit there and you throw that stupid ball at those dumb fucking pins.
Right.
The way he yelled at you, Howard, when he walked in, I wish I heard that tone of voice when Lady Gaga's microphone didn't work.
Right. You'll never see him erupt. Except for
he erupted.
Yeah. Oh, the bowling.
Well, I never got an answer. That's what, you know.
But you did. You got an answer.
No one.
You didn't want to hear what you heard.
He said, drop the bowling. I said, okay, I'll take. So
you didn't
let
like
me
the
take
answer.
Some. A couple of days off.
That's not dropping it.
A couple of days off to go bowl?
So what happens when an emergency comes up?
So are you needed around here or not?
Yeah, I'm needed.
You are? So then how can we let you go?
Okay. I got the answer.
All right.
But also, Howard, suppose some emergency now comes up and he needs a couple of days. He already took him for bowling.
Yeah, but that was good for you guys. You talked about it on the air. I remember when he was bowling the last time. We talked. Then they call and say, we want to get on the air with Scott. And I go, you know what? I'm not even that interested in getting an update on him.
I remember your exact words to me when we discussed it was, you go, Gary, I remember seeing Scott Boland show, and I don't remember it being stellar television. It was good once, but I don't think it merits doing it again.
It was boring.
Well, you should get Greg in here. Greg said it was the most boring week of his life. He said they shot like 80 hours to get like, you know, 10 minutes.
Is, I want to do a Robin dating show. I can't get a budget for that.
No, please send Scott.
Well, you know what I mean.
Well, everything was paid for. It wasn't. You didn't have to have a budget.
No, I understand that, but my guys, they get paid to sit there and stare at your ass for 80 hours.
In other words, the crew has to be paid.
Right. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Not you.
Look, Scott may have a future in bowling because the PBA CEO tells us his skills have impressed the other bowlers.
Let me tell you what impressed.
Yeah, they have, all right.
Here's what impressed the PBA. When I talk about it, they get attention. Nobody pays attention to bowling until I talk about it. It's got nothing to do with Scott. They're not looking for... If Scott wasn't on the show, there'd be no bowling.
Why didn't they say, quit, Scott, and come on the tour?
Well, they did invite me, even if, I said...
Well, there you go.
They invited me without coverage.
Yeah,
they said, if Howard doesn't want to cover it, you're still welcome to bowl.
So go bowl.
I can't, because I...
you got a job. I'm so sorry you've got a job.
Then I asked for
Scott,
the...
Scott, I'm so sorry
for the days
you
off.
Robin, do you have anything you want to do?
I'll tell you what I want to do.
What
do you
want to do? I can find something to do.
It was just a question. Everybody freaks out from a question.
Should Robin leave now? She's got something she has to do. She doesn't want to say what it is.
Okay.
She's a female.
Whatever.
I'll tell you what I want to do. I was just telling John Hine this. I've always wanted to go to the Super Bowl. Always wanted to go. It's on a Sunday night.
Go ahead.
Okay, so I've investigated it a million times. About 4 years ago, I actually got a friend to let me, was going to let me jump on his private jet home from Phoenix.
Go ahead.
But I still was nervous about when we'd land, so I found out we were going to land, scheduled to land somewhere between 4 and 5, and that made me nervous. So I spoke to the guy that runs all the private jets in the country. He told me the Super Bowl is the biggest night of the year for private jets.
Of course.
There's at least 300 in whatever town that's in.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you should land at 4, but I can't promise you that you will. So I said, I can't do it.
Right.
I got to be here.
That's right. You missed that on the Super
and
Bowl.
And I want
to
go.
Something I've been trying to do. I want to go to the Australian Open.
Well,
We're working during that time.
Why don't you go?
Take a
personal day.
It's a million miles away. I could never get back.
You know, Scott, which way do you want it? Do you want to be a player on the show and be important on the show? Or do you want to play it that you're so inconsequential that you can leave? Like, if Robin said to me, I'm listen, Howard, I love the show and everything, but I've got to see the Australian Open. I would tell her, you're out of your fucking mind. I need somebody here working with me.
Okay, I got an answer. I'm not bitching about it.
You had an answer 20 times ago.
Can I just say one more thing, Howard, just for Scott? And I do mean this as a friend. You know that you've been butting heads with Tim and management about stuff here. Do you think when stuff like that's going on, it's a good time to say, can I take 2 days off? When you're trying to show them your importance here and that we do need you?
He wants it both ways. I'm unimportant, I'm important.
No, I wanted an answer. An official
but
yes,
writing
no.
me is, no offense, I'm not trying to sound like some kind of asshole, but like, you know what? If I work at Microsoft, let me say something. I've got a brother-in-law who works at Microsoft. He doesn't have Bill Gates' home email, and he doesn't sit there and fucking hassle him. You understand what I'm saying?
I understand that.
About his personal days. That's something Gary handles here. That's his job. I wouldn't have Gary. If I want people contacting me, what do I need him for, those big teeth?
Wow. I had no idea.
Oh, you don't even know what goes on. You're protected. You were off in England ignoring the death of Steve Jobs.
You're protected from assholes like me.
Sorry.
Sorry I asked a question. I mean, that's all I was trying to do, was ask a question.
I want to be home with my wife.
I mean, okay.
All right. No, you know. By the way, how'd that go when you went home last night?
Yes, I'm not making any comments.
Yes, Steve.
Really?
Bad
it
night?
Wasn't good?
He is a jerk.
We asked him about it first thing this morning.
What did
he
say?
He was stoic. He said, everything's fine. I said, did you sleep on the couch?
Got him interested in covering.
Well, of course.
Yeah, can we send some cameras there?
I said, did you sleep on the couch? He's like, I never sleep on the couch. I was like, well, did you sleep in a different room?
I sleep in a box in the garage.
What did he say? He's the lord of the manor. Of course he is.
He said the floor was a little hard.
I am the king of my castle.
You had to sleep in a different room?
No.
Ay vey.
Well, what was the problem?
I slept in another state.
The problem?
Yeah, was there a problem?
You didn't do anything wrong.
I didn't think so. I mean, people piled on in the wrap-up show, too, and...
Well, listen, I don't know anything about
Ralph
that.
Ralph and Richie, and so that I didn't think was fair. I mean, when you get involved with people on the show,
right,
things, you know, can go wrong.
Right, absolutely, but you're not to blame. Listen, your wife decided to call in. Who told her to do that? That was crazy.
Because
I love when... If your wife called in every day, I'd be happy.
I know.
Then you could go bowl, because then I'd have her.
I wouldn't be happy.
I'd hire her in a minute.
I wouldn't be happy.
Right.
But people on the wrap-up show suggested callers that I didn't defend my wife.
Oh, really?
I thought that, you know...
Well, how are you supposed to defend her? She was doing fine on her own.
That's what
She's
I said.
She's a firecracker.
That was my answer. Right.
She didn't need you to defend her.
Well, I defended her when I thought she needed defending. You know, when things got a little out of hand, I said, you know, they accused her of wanting to leave early. I said, that was me. I had to leave early.
Right.
It wasn't her. She didn't have anything to do with that.
You're a beaten man. You can't bowl.
And you
got to go home and
gotta
listen to
Vegas
that.
And bowl. Please.
Yeah. So she was mad at you, but why was she mad at you? Who knows?
She was a little upset. But
did you argue or you just gave up?
You know how it goes.
Right.
I'm not going to, you know.
I'll go straight to the attic.
I'm not going to.
Listen.
Please, let me go bowling.
I know you love. I know you love bowling.
Send me away for a week.
I know you love bowling.
I do.
I know you do.
Yeah, I do. And it, you know,
but listen,
bowling.
The TV guys told me it was the most boring.
For
week
them,
of
it was
life.
Boring. I could.
The TV show to me was boring.
Okay,
no offense.
That's cool.
I mean,
that's...
watching you bowl. I'd rather watch Wendy. I'd rather put the resources into Wendy the retard bowling if the PBA wants to put her on that.
Yeah,
I'm
maybe I'll bring her out there.
Right.
No, I get it. It's not exciting. It really. I mean, for
it's
that's
terrible.
Why bowling is having a problem.
I mean, but if you're asking me, and I don't like to get involved in this, but I would rather have my engineer here with me than hear that you're off bowling, which I can't really do anything
okay,
with.
Okay, Fine.
It would be another thing if you were top of the PGA Tour, and if you don't go, you're going to miss a $100 million payday.
And you know what was weird? Like, the whole premise was that, like, Scott's a good enough bowler that maybe he'll win the whole thing.
No, no, no.
And not only didn't he win the whole thing, like,
he wasn't even qualified.
He was just sort of at the bottom. He wasn't the worst bowler. He wasn't a great bowler. It was just such a disappointment on every level.
I'm not going to win the whole thing, obviously. Those guys are so good that, I mean, it's.
But
we know.
And you're boring.
And that's the only reason to take time off if you're the greatest.
Like, if Scott was bowling naked, okay, then I could see it'd be funny.
All right, maybe we can work something
out. Once! It doesn't take 80 hours to cover that.
Believe me, no one wants to see me naked.
You know, the words bowling and boring are almost identical, except for two letters. Think about it. I've thought about it. Oh, when I got that letter, the email
at
home.
Your hair must have stood on
it. I was just listen, like, oh, shit. This fucking guy's asking me. I know I told Doug no, or I was thinking about it, but.
I've got a personal email.
And then right after the show, he comes up to me. Hey, did you get my email about bowling? And I was like, Scott, I'm on it. I'm aware of it. You know, but someone will get back to you.
What is it that gives into people around
here? No, I was being pressured for an answer.
They know that they're irritating you.
Right.
But they do it anyway.
I didn't want to irritate
you. Because they know I'm a nice guy. Most guys would just fire him.
That's right.
They were just like, they'd say, listen, get him out of here. Yeah.
He asked a question, get him out of here.
Right. No.
I appreciate you can ask me anything you want,
but when it comes to that kind of stuff, that's Gary's job. You know what Gary's job is.
I appreciate you value me as an employee, and you want me here.
Yeah, that's right.
I get it.
Yeah, what are we paying you for?
No, I get it. I understand, and I'm grateful for that.
So go get to work.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, leave it there.
Yeah, leave it there. Get to work. Get passionate. You don't know what goes on. And saw how he came in?
That was amazing.
He's been festering. Like Uncle Fester.
You know, I need an answer.
He looks like Uncle Fester, and he was festering.
Everyone. I thought his head was going to spin.
That vein popping out scared me.
Yeah, and I mean, you've covered war.
I've seen a lot. I've been to Iraq. I've been to Guantanamo Bay. I have seen a lot. That vein might have scared me more than the streets of Baghdad.
That's right. That's right. When he goes off, he goes off.
I got to get out of here.
And it goes off over bowling.
You. Go ahead.
Two more quick things, then I got to run.
Right.
Richard Christie's new Charred Walls of the Damned album comes out today.
Yeah.
It's called Cold Winds on Timeless Days. Richard will be making some appearances in Brooklyn tonight.
He doesn't make any money with this music, does he?
I don't think so, but I think he loves doing it, obviously.
There were a ton of drums in here yesterday. What was he doing?
I don't know, but I was thinking about Richard. You know, I got a copy of his record.
We ought to play a little bit of it, shouldn't we?
Yeah, I guess. But, you know, it's a funny thing. He's such an accomplished drummer that if he had just kind of like hooked up with the right band, like he'd be the drummer.
Oh, he would never hook up with the right band.
Right, of course not. But he would be the drummer like in Metallica.
Sure.
There's no doubt he could handle that duty. Like when Lars was here, I wanted him actually to invite Richard up to play because he could handle it. But Lars doesn't have a way of knowing that.
Right.
And I said, if the guy had just gotten into with anybody with any half a talent, you know, Metallica or Led Zeppelin type band or someone big.
Korn.
Robin would be sleeping with him right now. He was in Korn. But he never hooked up. He sat in a garage, I think.
He was in a warehouse, storage facility.
Yeah, real quick. Let's see our lesson. I don't know the names of these songs. Let me see. Here he is. He showed up.
And he writes all of this himself and everything.
He writes them all himself. You know, it's a shame. You're such a talented drummer, but you never could hook up with the right people.
And why not become a session drummer? Why not work with studio?
I've done that
before.
Did
you ever smell him?
Who wants to be in a studio with
a session.
Me? No, but you know, there's drummers that are a million times better than me that never make it too. Yeah,
I know,
it's just the luck of the draw.
I was just thinking of you. And I know you're sitting, you write this music.
Plus, I'm here. This is the greatest job I would want. Better than any band.
For this in any way?
It's starting to come in a little bit.
Come on, be honest. Did they give you an advance?
Yeah.
Oh, they did. Oh, okay.
But I mean, most of that goes to recording costs. But yeah, it's enough to pay the band.
How much money did you make?
Me personally, maybe a few thousand.
$3,000?
Yeah, somewhere around there.
All right. Well,
did you have to share it with Sal since you guys are? partner?
No, but I pay the band members and stuff.
You do?
Yeah.
I mean, is it a band or are these just guys who play behind you because you write everything and
I write everything and they play it, but I treat it like a band because they're
my
friends.
Let me hear this. All right, that's very nice.
Thank you. Sounds like
Aerosmith a little bit. I'm reminiscent. A little more mainstream.
So it's heavy here.
Oh, it does. With that racket.
He's got to start making noise.
Yeah, how old are you again?
37. Yeah. Still in my 30s.
This is good. I like this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Fred not good enough to play on your record?
I would be honored.
He's got a different style. I can't handle this.
You don't do this.
I can't handle it.
Right.
I couldn't play it.
You have a nervous breakdown. That's good.
Thank you.
Who's the guy on the guitar?
Jason Sukoff, one of my best friends.
Better than Sal?
I don't know about that, no. But he's a good friend.
Gotta kill one of them.
Sorry, Jason.
Who's singing?
His name's Tim Ripper Owens. He's the guy that made that movie Rockstar about that sang in a Judas Priest cover band then joined Judas Priest.
I thought Mark Wahlberg was in that movie.
He plays him. The singer, yeah.
You mean your friend is who it's based on?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I met a guy the other day told me it was based on him, too. Oh, this is just in breaking news. Scott is in the hallway screaming right now at Tim Sabian.
Oh, God.
Yeah, you maybe should be going.
I got to get out there.
We'll tape it a minute.
We were isolating Scott when he was yelling earlier. It was it'll make some good calls.
Yeah, good. Phony phone calls. Hey, I should play one of Richard's phony phone calls.
Oh, you don't want the music
anymore? Well, I mean, I don't know. Do any of the other songs sound different than that one?
Yeah. How about song 9, I think you would like. It gets right to the point.
Okay. This sounds very busy to me. No, I'm not a music critic.
Yeah, but right here it starts rocking out.
If I was on America's Got Talent, I'd throw you right off the stage at this point. I'd hit that big X, man.
The gong.
Oh, all right, there you go. I understand. It's a heavy metal sound, right?
Yeah.
How many people bought the last album?
You know, I think we did about 25 or 30,000 worldwide.
Right.
Yeah,
all right.
Worldwide.
Uh-huh.
How many people are in the world, Robin?
7 billion.
You sold 30,000.
Yeah, but
way to go, Steve Jobs Jr.
Some kid in Indonesia loves us. So.
We have fans in every
part of the world. We're going to Indonesia.
Yeah, we have a tour in someone's living room. This music really touches me.
I get emails from kids in, like, you know, even like Iran and countries where they know my music, but they don't know
just
what I do here.
They fly into a building, they're playing this song.
but they'll see pictures of me licking Sal's balls on the internet, and they're like, "What do you do at your job?"
We conquered 3 blocks in Japan. Oof. That's not my cup of tea.
How about
Simon and Garfunkel to go? Old friends, silently staring like bookends.
We have a There's a song with a pretty acoustic part at the beginning.
I like a song I can get a massage to and sleep during it.
Wait, no, this is not your album.
This is. Hey. It's not for me, but listen, your fans are out there. Oh, they love it.
And thank you for playing it, Howard. I appreciate it.
You write the words?
Uh-huh.
What are you singing about?
Yeah.
Heavy stuff. Deeper stuff than you would think I am capable of.
You got anything that sounds like this?
And stays like this.
Yeah. Don't rub my right foot, it hurts. Beautiful song. Newspaper blown through the grass falls on the round toes of the high shoes. Nice. Of the old can you spend more time on my feet than my hands? Please. Can you do an hour of just hands? Is that done? Waiting for the sun.
Kevin and I get a massage. I'm like,
of course.
Oh, it's so beautiful. Oh, I crave that so much.
They say it's good for you to sleep during a massage.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah.
Oh, please.
I'm getting a pumpkin massage later this month.
Oh, here we go.
Oh, my God. All right, I got to take a break. Richard's new album is called what?
Cold Winds on Timeless Days.
Cold Winds on Timeless Days. Charred Walls of the Dam. I was going to say Charles Waltz.
Charles Waltz.
Charles Waltz.
Charles Waltz.
Richard made a new phony phone call. I'll get to that. You know, I better take a break.
Okay.
Oh, you sure?
Well, yeah, we'll get to it.
Yeah. The phony phone call. Come on.
Yeah, we'll get to it, but I know I got...
Can't it just be the Richard Christie show for the next 45,
well, it's
six
like,
hours?
No, I haven't taken a break this hour. I got it.
Okay.
All right. We'll be back right after these words.
Here's Richard Simmons on the Food Network.
What do you indulge in?
I like to lick food ads in magazines.
Yeah. I do too! Yeah.
This is a wonderful party dish.
Paula,
I think why I love you so much is because you remind me of my mom, who's passed away, and I loved her very much, and she had a personality like you, and she taught me how to laugh, and she taught me how to be a clown to help other people. And when I came on the show, I had to say that my mother is looking up in heaven in her kitchen.
Oh my God.
And she just would love you.
But we do have the opportunity through food to reach back and touch and stay in
connected.
Touch. Yes, stay connected.
And the reason I really came today was because I wanted you to be my
and
mother.
That is, I'll be your mother. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
The Howard Stern Show. No more bullshit. The Howard Stern Show.
But anyway, 1 minute. Water is so good when it's cold. Okay, so we're taking your calls on love, health, wealth, marriage, career, things of that nature. Good afternoon and welcome to Telepsychic and thank you for calling.
Hi, Morris. How are you today?
Okay, and you?
I'm good, thank you. I had a question about my pet.
Your who?
About my pet dog.
Oh, your pet dog?
Yeah, I have a pet chihuahua, and I was wondering, when is it going to stop biting me while I fuck it?
Okay. Good afternoon, and welcome to Telepsychic, and thank you for calling.
Yeah, hi, Morris. Can I get a prediction? When are you going to let me jerk your cock off?
Where are we going, and what are we doing in this country? Oh, what? Okay. Good afternoon and welcome to Telepsychic and thank you for calling.
Hi,
I think we talked for a long time ago, didn't we?
No, we never spoke before.
No, but the features are almost the same. Okay, but I feel things are going to be okay there.
I got my black pecker stuck in the VCR.
Yep.
We like to know a little bit about you for our pal. We like to help you learn or help yourself. Look around you, all you see are sympathetic eyes. Stroll around the grounds until you feel at home. And here's to you, Mrs. Robinson. Oh, Jesus loves you more than you will know. God bless you, please, Mrs. Robinson. Heaven knows a place for those who pray. Hey, 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 hey. just a Robinson's affair. Most of all, you got to hide from the kids. Here's to you, Mrs. Robinson. Jesus loves you more than you will know. Whoa, whoa, whoa. God bless you, please, Mrs. Robinson.
What, where's this from?
I think it's from MTV.
I love Paul Simon. Rosie O'Donnell's on the phone. Well, first of all, Rosie, congratulations. You got an excellent write-up in the Post today about your new show. They're saying it's a breath of fresh air, the blah, 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 going on and on, raving. Hollywood Reporter, excellent review. They say the show is not sterile, that things are being mixed up, that you never know what you're going to get.
Well, that's always good.
You're getting hip reviews.
That's nice. I just woke up. I haven't read anything, so I'm happy to hear that.
Where are you now, in Chicago?
I'm in Chicago, in my very cold dressing room.
With Oprah's staff. Now, here's my prediction.
Go ahead.
And I don't know a thing, but this is I have intuition.
You got a hunch.
And you can deny it if you want.
I might.
Oprah's staff likes things...
Is it Oprah's staff?
Yes. Rosie was given Oprah's staff. Listen, it's a very successful staff.
Okay.
But they like doing things where everything is very packaged, very produced. Rosie likes to let things evolve and happen.
And Rosie's Rosie. She's not Oprah.
She's not Oprah. I predict within a year, Rosie,
all new staff.
All new staff. That's my prediction.
Well, you know, you're not going to be psychic of the year, because here's the thing. It's only about three of people from her senior staff.
Okay.
And the rest of them were all young, new kids who had worked at her staff for about 5 to 8 years. So they're in their 20s, most of them. So they're quite trainable, right? But I will tell you, you're right about initially, they were worried about the fact that I don't use the prompter. Because normally they have a prompter and everybody follows it in the control room.
Right.
And so that's the reason we went live, Howard, which I think you'll understand better than anyone, is all the practice shows, you know, I would do something and then after, you know, we got to go, we'll be right back. And they'd say, we're going to have to do that again. I'm like, why? Well, you forgot to say NBC is the voice.
Right.
I'm like, oh, dear Lord.
That's not going to fly with you.
Okay, so Thursday, after the test show, I had a meeting with Lisa Erspalmer, who's, you know, one of the head Oprah people. She and Sherry Salata, like, ran it for 25 years, ran her show. And my two executive producers and I was like, okay, listen, I'm not willing to trade something real for something fake. Just because something's real and has a little few flaws in it does not make it less valuable than something that's perfect and sterile and ridiculous.
Right.
And they're like, well, how could we fix that? I said, we could go live. Cut to, they said, okay. Which I never thought they would do, because I thought they'd be worried that I might, you know.
The whole show is live.
Live.
Wonderful.
Is this going to kill you? I'm saying right now it's fun, you know, the first show.
Yeah, it's the first blush. You've been back.
You've been having a great life. You've been enjoying hanging out.
Yeah.
Is this going to kill you?
I pray to God it's not going to kill me, but I was hanging out for 10 years, Howard.
So what?
That's a lot. 10 years, man, of doing nothing. You try it. It's not easy.
You were going stir crazy.
Listen, you know, my kids were raised. They were all in school. My youngest is you know, going to be 9 years old, and I didn't have anything to do.
I can't keep up with you. You baffle me.
Why?
Because, you know, Rosie and I never had a private conversation, really.
I mean,
you know, I mean, not where we got, we've threatened to get together for dinner, but there's always there's always a complication.
Oh, dear.
But
she's hard to schedule with.
Yeah.
Is hard to schedule with.
But she is. She's difficult. But
yeah.
You fascinate me.
I do.
When I came into your life, you had met you had a new girlfriend.
Yeah.
She moved the whole family in. She had six kids. You have four kids.
Yeah.
You were blended.
They didn't move them in. They moved them next door.
You were in the process of what you called blending the families.
Yeah.
Now, somehow that relationship ended.
Yeah.
And then.
Which I believe was predicted by you.
Oh, yeah. Well, because you were going probably insane with her six kids. Let's be honest. That's too many kids.
Let's be honest. You know, you have a vision of what you think would work, and I remember that movie, Yours, Mine, and Ours, with Lucille Ball.
Right.
And I thought, well, how?
That's what you were thinking.
Yeah.
This could be perfect, right? But honestly, you know, it was a lot of kids, and that's the truth. It was a lot of kids.
It ruined the relationship.
I wouldn't say ruined, but it didn't allow for any time for she and I to be together alone. And
right.
You know, There were lots of kids with lots of different issues. And,
right.
You know, I got my own four, and they have their own challenges, right? And so it just felt to me like chaos and too much. And she's a lovely, lovely person.
So in other words, you saw this movie and had the idea. The kids didn't see the movie. That was the problem.
No, but they right. did see the one with Steve Martin, Cheaper by the Dozen.
Yes. Now, was it complicated when you had to go, like when you broke up? I can't even imagine the hassle. First of all, you got to move her out of the house.
You know, which literally she did in 3 days over Christmas. It was very quick.
And then
over Christmas,
you had to go, and you had to go over Christmas, no less.
Oof.
Then you had to go to the kids and say, "Listen, remember the movie I watched?"
Turns out it doesn't work like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, that was the movies, kids.
Yeah, now we have a different movie to watch.
Was that a horrible...
No, because, you know, the kids knew. The kids knew in the beginning, like I said, you know, here's the thing, you know, we're going to see what happens. And,
right.
And I love Tracy, and we're going to see what happens. And so the fact that we didn't live in one house, I think, was helpful in terms of them not feeling as, you know, upset. Or they sort of, you know, there was a separation, and there were. It wasn't like we did every holiday together. In fact, we didn't really do that. I took my kids and did what we normally did, and she did what she normally did.
And Tracy had to be brokenhearted because, listen, nabbing a Rosie is a big deal.
Nabbing. I love that.
Well, let's be honest.
You think I'm nabbable?
Well, listen.
Well, you're acting like she lost a Porsche.
She's a bit. Well, yeah. Rosie's a big star. She is the pride.
It's more like a Hyundai Sonata, Robin. I don't know if it was a Porsche.
She is the home run of home runs. She's wealthy. She's, you know, listen. She's everything
a
woman.
She's also a good person.
Yeah, right. So, when you broke up with her, it had to be, the worst.
Well, just so you know, it was not. It was. She made the decision. It wasn't. You know. She said, "This is not going to work for me, and I'm going to go."
Well, in other words, you acted so miserable.
No, I just knew. I knew fairly early on that a long time future and forever wasn't in the cards, and that I loved her very much, and I care about her kids, and I care about her life, and you know, and what I think we ended up wanting different things. Although in the beginning, it was a great. Immense love affair, and it's wonderful to feel those kinds of feelings. And I had, you know, been in a relationship for a long time. That towards
right.
the end was kind of, you know, when people are about to divorce, it's a couple years of rockiness, right? So,
and here's what else baffles me.
What's that?
Okay, so this whole moving to Chicago thing, I don't get. Now, Parker is in military school, so he's covered.
And loves it.
Can you
really?
Believe this?
The military.
I cannot believe it, truthfully. He's been asking since he was 8.
Wow.
And I was
Yeah,
obsessed with everything. Like, can tell you everything General Patton ever did. Could tell you who was in what war, what countries, and why. And
do you think he'll become a military guy?
That's what he's always wanted. And, you know, and I was really concerned, to tell you the truth. He's 16. When I left my show, I kept him in first grade twice because I wanted him to sort of, you know, get relearn and have focus. And I wasn't home during my, you know, the show. So
right.
he did first grade twice. So he's older than most of the kids in 10th grade. He's 16. Most of them are 15.
Right.
And when Bin Laden was killed, he was awake. We were in my room. And I really was panicked that something huge was going to happen. You know, like they dropped the nuclear bomb because the president doesn't give a press conference on a Sunday night.
Right.
And they announce that he's dead, and my son goes, "Oh, shit." And I go, "What, honey?" He goes, "I wanted a shot at him, Mom." And he was
this
dead
is some
serious.
Kid. This is some kid.
Dead serious.
Here you are,
know?
A peacenik, right? You are someone.
Totally.
And this kid is rebelling by becoming a military guy.
Well, that's what I said. I said, "How do you piss off your left-wing, liberal, pacifist, lesbian mother? You join the military, you know?"
But, and
like,
you were the
you want to stay home and get drunk and have crazy sex?
Right.
Your parents? He's like, you know, yeah, I'm going to do that as well, Mom, but I first want to serve my nation. I'm like, okay, baby.
Wow.
You know?
Doesn't this blow your mind in the sense that you were the type of mother, from what I could understand, that was up this kid's ass? I mean, he couldn't make a move without you.
Yeah, I'm madly in love with him.
And all of a sudden now, he's moving out of the house.
He's
at
gone.
16. He's gone.
Yeah, it wasn't really all of a sudden. You know, I mean, he's seen every movie about military school and stuff, and he saw Taps, so I'm partially blaming Tom Cruise. But he saw Taps, and he was like, "Mom, I want to go to that school."
Is he into
and
guns?
Then, excuse me?
Is he into guns?
Well, he'll tell you every caliber. He's never
wow.
shot a gun. We don't have a gun in the house. But he knows, like, when we're watching a show, he'll go, "Oh, Mom, that's a 15 millimeter CC from a Nighthawk Fire Ranger pack. He knows.
Is he into hand to hand combat? Does he take karate and all that?
No, but he's into football and athletics, and he's, right, you know, he's very sort of cut, and he's like, he looks like he belongs in, like, when I saw him in his uniform, they had the graduation,
right,
from the, you know, plebe to the cadet, and I was up there 2 weekends ago, and I was stunned. And here he is, like, 6'1". He lost 20 pounds there. He's fit. He's cut, and he's so happy.
Wow.
And everywhere we went, like, I took him out to dinner to celebrate, and we're at some steakhouse up in Valley Forge, and people in the waiting, you know, to get a seat said to him, thank you for your service, because he looks like he's in the Navy.
Right.
Like, wow.
And wow.
He goes, thank you, ma'am. I'm still a cadet, but I will pass on that to the men in the arms. He even said the whole thing, you know.
Wow.
He called me ma'am once, Howard, and I almost had, like, an aneurysm.
You're kidding.
I'm like, honey, you do not ma'am me ever.
This
it
sounds
disrespectful,
like,
disrespectful to ma'am your mother.
You're not kidding. This sounds like, remember that show with Michael J. Fox? He was like a Republican, but his parents were hippies.
Oh, he's not a Republican.
No, but I'm saying he comes from this peace. You know, you were even, you personally were upset that they killed bin Laden because you felt he deserved a trial.
He's opposed to war.
You wanted a trial for him.
Yeah, I wanted to know if it was legal in the nation, you know, that we live to do this, right?
Right.
I questioned whether or not it was legal. Is it legal to do that?
Right.
Right? But he's a Democrat, though. My son said, he goes, Mom, in the whole school, there's like 5 Democrats. He said, I get into the greatest discussions about, you know, what's going on politically. And he grew up in a family where we discussed politics at the dinner table. So he's well-versed in
what's
going on.
But here is the turnaround in your life. You left your first show, which was very successful, because you wanted to be home with the family. The kids were young.
Right.
Now, all of a sudden, you're living in Chicago. You got your one daughter with you. Two of the daughters are living with Kelly.
A daughter and a son.
A daughter and a son are living with Kelly.
Well, they're doing halftime, right? So the oldest boy, Parker's away. Chelsea's living with me. And the two little ones are doing, you know, half and half.
I feel like you're free and clear now. With the kids. I mean, I feel they're back to being, you know.
She dropped them all.
I feel you got everyone sort of in somewhere and stashed away. And then you're running around in Chicago.
Yeah, I'm at all the gay bars dancing until 3 in the morning.
No, you have a new girlfriend.
Exactly, who you will love, Howard. Because remember when you were saying to me, hey, did you have a crush on Beth? And I said to you, when she did The View, and I was like, no, she's too perfect for me. I'd be too intimidated to go near a woman who looked like that.
Right.
Cut to, I'm in Starbucks, and I see this woman in front of me, dressed perfectly, very Beth-like,
right,
holding a puppy, and I have a puppy just like it, and I was thinking of getting another one for Chicago, and
right,
I thought she was a straight 28-year-old, because that's what she looked like, and I start talking to her, and I'm like, you know.
And by the way, this one, just so I'm clear, this one doesn't have any kids, right?
No kids.
Perfect. All right, go ahead.
Perfect.
Yeah, and you're not having kids with her, right?
Not at the moment.
All right,
but,
go ahead.
Yeah, so she's holding the puppy, and I'm like, you know, I got a dog like that. Where did you get it? And we start talking, and I said, here's the thing.
Were you hitting on her?
No, because I didn't think she was gay at all. If, you know, it's like if she's got a Beth vibe, honey. She wears high heels and Prada belts and a lot of jewelry. Like, I thought she was just a straight girl.
So your gaydar wasn't going wild.
Honey, not only was it not going wild, it didn't even register a possible blip.
But why did you start talking to her? Because she was beautiful?
No, because of the dog.
Exactly, because
of
the dog.
Yeah, but listen, Rosie sees 50 people a day with dogs. She tells them to fuck off. Why did this one she's all of a sudden talking to?
I'll tell you why. Because I have a 4-pound chihuahua, and she was holding a 3-pound Pomeranian.
Right.
And I wanted to know if it was full grown, because, you know, I can't bring the big dogs back and forth. So I have a little chihuahua, and my daughter Chelsea, who's living with me here, I want to get her a little one so Missy would have a friend and blah blah blah.
So when you're talking to her,
yeah,
does she recognize right away it's Rosie O'Donnell?
I think so.
Okay,
yes.
Well, go ahead.
But she didn't say it, you know.
And she's wearing a little hot dress, and she's got high heels on.
No, she's got like jeans that you know your thigh don't touch kind of jeans.
Right,
skinny,
and she's 28.
No, she's 40.
40.
She looked 28.
Tight, right? Ass, big boobs, the whole thing.
Honey, you're a dream girl. I'm
really?
Remember in the studio?
Who does she look like?
Julianne Moore.
Oh, my.
Yes, red hair, green eyes.
So you're talking to her.
I'm talking to her, and I said, you know, here's what happened to me. I got a little chihuahua. when I was 33, and the next thing I knew, I had a son. So you're probably going to get to have a baby soon. And she, you know, told me that she was trying to have a baby. And, you know, and I said, oh, well, you know, maybe your husband. But she said, oh, I don't have a husband. I'm a lesbian. And I laughed. I was like, I said, that's funny.
Bingo.
I said, you're funny. What's your name? And she said, you know, Michelle. I go, no, seriously. She goes, no, I am a lesbian. I go, you're a lesbian. If you're a lesbian, you're one of those lesbians for 14 minutes. You're not a real. She says, I've been out since I'm 24 years old.
Wow.
I'm like, and how old are you now? 28? She said, no, 40. I go, first of all, I thought it was Ashton Kutcher on Punk'd for a minute.
This is too good to be true.
Well, yeah, and then I didn't trust her for a while. I'm like,
well, what do you mean you didn't trust her?
Because, like I said, I was intimidated by the beauty. I was a little thrown by the, I don't know.
Well, Kelly was beautiful, but you're talking about a whole nother level up.
Kelly is beautiful, and it's not about levels. It's just about she's very much of a girl. I've never dated a woman who is so much
so feminine.
Exactly.
So wait, like, a second. You meet this girl in Starbucks.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, here's a picture of her.
Oh, your picture's flying.
Oh,
in.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, you enjoy that, Howard?
Oh, yeah, baby.
I thought you might like that. I thought of you.
You'll bring her over to my
more
place.
Than once. We'll more than
her,
once, Howard.
We'll get her in a bikini.
Oh, yeah, she has a few.
Oh, look at her. She is lovely.
Yeah.
Is she wearing a wedding ring with you?
No, she does not wear a wedding ring.
Does it appears to be. Wow. She's some knockout.
Yeah.
You know how to handle something like that?
Howard, that was my concern. I was like, hey, what have I...
You meet her in Starbucks. How long before you take her out on a date?
About 2 weeks.
What did you do? You started texting and calling?
Yeah, you know, my daughter was in the hospital for a while, and so I was going back and forth to the city.
What is that all about? Is she all right?
Yeah, she's okay. But, you know, for my 14-year-old. And so I was in and out of the city a lot for like a month.